Yeah, so again, there's no hiding, no deceiving. You can't hide from the Most High. And because I was having this conversation just last night, and I had it before, right, about how so many Israelites who've awakened, the majority that I've seen that have awakened to the fact that they're Israel are still caught and hung up into Judaism and/or Christianity, and then also you have these Israelites who, go so far on the path, and then as more are more of the way of Yah is revealed to them, they still refuse to submit and obey. They come up with their own isms, what they're going to do, right? And as it says in the book, they refuse to hear the way of Yah. They, want to make up their own ways and say they are doing the way of the Most High, but they're not. And this is why, again, Yah is very angry. I talked about that a few months ago, right? And in the past, he's very angry, as he says in the 42nd chapter of Yeshayah, right? Isaiah, right? For a long time, he's held his peace, through the three dominions of man, Babylon, Media Persia, Grecia, right? I mean, we can see the light going out. We can see Yah was bringing illumination in those three dominions, right? Prophecy still, right? Basically, and when I say that, not so many, not prophecies in the third dominion of man, but prophecies in the first and second dominion of man, right? Because Malachi was contemporary with Nehemiah, right? Yah raised up Malachi when Nehemiah came back the second and last time, as I said earlier, in 424, 423 BCE, to Jerusalem, because he was made governor over Jerusalem by Artaxerxes in 445 BCE, right? And this is the governor, again, Nehemiah, that's Yah's talking about in Malachi chapter 1. And then, Daniel talked about what was going to take place basically in the Greek dominion, right? And this is when the illuminated Edomite became. And started to become, should I say, illuminated. As I said, 330, 329, 328 BCE, they got a hold of the book of remembrance that had been put together. Once, those are the descendants of Yehuda, Benjamin, and Levi who were still in Jerusalem at the time of Nehemiah, right? He came the second time, he came back to Jerusalem, still governor over Jerusalem. And he had that book of Daniel. I know he had the book of Daniel. And then they could see, as we have denoted in the past, Malachi chapter 3, what verse, let me just read it to you verbatim so I don't, put you right on it, right? Malachi 3, verse. Verse 13, right? Your words have been stout against me, saith Yah, yet you say, what have we spoken so much against thee? You have said, it is worthless, vain to serve me. This is Yah talking. And what profit is it that we have kept, you have kept my ordinances, that and that you have walked mournfully before me, Yah of hosts, right? This is Yah talking through Malachi. And now we call the proud happy, yes. They that work wickedness are set up, yes. They that tempt me, oh Yah, are even delivered. So, again, the reason why they said it was vain to serve Yah, right, verse 13, is because now they've become knowledgeable of the book of Daniel. They put it with the rest of the scrolls and the prophets, Yeshaya, Yeremiah, Micah, and so on and so forth, right? And then they were illuminated even that much more. Ezekiel, right? They were illuminated that much more. And they understood that this, curse was on them, and that this captivity was going to be long, much longer than they realized. And they were just in the second dominion then. And so it was another two dominions of man left, right? And they knew they were going to die under other people, their children's 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 children, you know, like I said, you understand, for many more years. And they probably understood that they were talking about over 2,000 years, okay, that this was going to go on. Because, again, this is now, this is, like I say, 423 BCE, more likely, 423, 422 BCE. Here we are, what, 2020 CEAD, right? And again, they were disheartened, many of them, not all, right? And they were like, what good is it that we have walked mournfully before Yah, obeying his laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts? But as I pointed out in the past, all you got to do is read chapter 1 and chapter 2 Malachi and see what Yah says they were really doing. And we're just talking about the ones that were still in the land back then in 424, 423, 422, 421 BCE. Because most of Israel was gone. Because as we can see in 536, when Cyrus gave the command and put forth the proclamation that all Israel could return and build that second temple, only a remnant came back, 42,360. Right? You understand? Ezra chapter 2. Right? And at that time, how many Israelites, probably on the face of the earth? I mean, what, 3-4 million maybe? 2-3 million? But only 42,360 came back. So, it was only a remnant still, in the land. In my mind, most of them, they threw in the towel. They like, hey, ain't no need us keeping these laws. We might as well do what we want. But you had Nehemiah and others, as I said in the past, no, we got to keep these laws. Because if we do, Yah keep our seed, huh? Our descendants, seeds and eggs on the face of this earth. They'll be here, you follow what I'm saying, at the end of the four dominions of man, coming into the end of the four dominions of man. And you understand? That's why we've got this book of remembrance, right? That's when Yah said he heard them talking. And he put the spirit in the ones, without a doubt, that was saying they got to do the law, right? Let's put all these scrolls together in one compilation for our children at the end time. You follow what I'm saying? Just like we see in Daniel chapter 12, right? Which, again, that's the first division of Daniel, 11:36 to 12:10 Daniel. And what did Gabriel? We know that was Gabriel standing on the water dressed in linen, right? Because of what it says in Daniel chapter 9, right? What is that, verse 21, right? Let me read it to you. Put you right on it. So, hopefully you can see what Yah's allowed us to see here. And we've talked about this, in the past, right? Daniel chapter 9, verse 21, right? Yes, while I was speaking, this is Daniel, in prayer, even the man Gabriel, whom I had seen in the vision at the beginning. See, and we know 11:36 to 12:10 is the first vision Daniel got. And what did Gabriel say to Daniel in, chapter 12, right? When I picked this up, right, at matter of fact, I'll just pick it up from verse 1 in chapter 12, but this is a continuation from 11:36, right? That's this first vision, and we don't have all the first vision because Esau, the illuminated Edomite, has taken away the introduction to this vision and so much, but Yah made him leave what we needed, so that we could see this in clarity, right? And I'll pick it up in verse 1 in chapter 12, but again, this is a continuation from 11:36, Daniel. And at that time, right? And what time is this? Verse 45, right? King of the South, Islam, right, shall plant the tabernacles, plural, of his palace, between the seas and the glorious holy mountain, right? That's Jerusalem, right? And between the seas, the South Sea, Dead Sea, the Mediterranean Sea, right? And we can see that those two palaces are still there, right? Plural, tabernacles, two palaces, El Asmas, Dome of the Rock, to this day. But what does Yah say, right? Yet he, the king of the south, Islam, shall come to his end, and none shall help him. And at that time shall Michael stand up, Michael, right? The great prince, angel, chief angel, right? Which stands for the children of thy people, right? He's standing, watching, protecting, you know, Israel, right? And definitely the Israel who has turned to Yah with all their heart and soul, and those who are turning and will turn with all their heart and soul, but are in the midst of turning, right? And then even some, you know, I'm sure, without question, who are still snared up, caught up, hung up, don't really understand that Judaism, Hasidism, Judaism, Christianity is religions and the concepts of Esau, right? And possibly even some who caught up and snared up in Islam, you understand, who going to see, who don't see yet, right? Like our so-called brothers and sisters, descendants out of the 6.5 tribes, so-called Palestinians, and others of those of our brothers and sisters out of the 10 tribes that are scattered in the east. Some of them are over on this side of the earth today, been over here for a while now, right, on the west side of the earth, in Europe or whatever, but they're in Islam. Follow what I'm saying? They're snared and caught in that. But in my mind, I have no doubt that some of them will turn, awaken, and turn, just like what we see in Zechariah chapter 10, right? When Yah's talking about descendants out of the 10 tribes of Israel, Samaria, Israel, Ephraim, right? Different, you know, connotations they were, you know, applied to the 10 tribes, right? And they will awake and remember Yah in far countries and turn again with their children to Yah. See? So, right? But what does it say here? And there, you know, shall be a time of trouble such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. Well, that's the time we're living in right now, you know, with the illuminated Edomites and their plandemic that they planned out, right? I mean, the Rockefeller Foundation back in 2010, they put people that they mentioned the Rockefeller Foundation the other day. I'm listening, I'm pretty sure it was Democracy Now! With this Amy Goodman, right? Again, funded by George Soros, Democracy Now!, right? You follow what I'm saying? This is all planned out. You understand what I'm saying? And they got this media propaganda campaign, right? And it attacking the nations of the world with this so-called pandemic. And again, you've only had a little over 700,000 people, so they say, that have died from this COVID-19. Right? But the population of the earth is from what I hear, is 7.8 billion people. So what percentage is that of the people who have died, supposedly, a little over 700,000, right, from this so-called COVID-19 that they're calling a pandemic, right, virulent and whatnot. But as they say, it's only a little over 700,000 that have died so far, right? Now, they say it's like over 18 million that have been infected. But again, I ask you, you know, what percentage of that is 7.8 billion people? Is what they say is on the face of the earth today. And I mean, I really don't know how they can, you know what I mean? They got a generalized total, because I mean, people born and dying every day for whatever reasons, right? Okay, so again, what percentage is that? You see what I'm saying? And as I said a few months ago, unless you get shot full of holes with a gun, or, you know, you get blown up, like what happened in Beirut yesterday, and I'm going to mention that again. I know many of you, if not all of you, know about that now. Or get hit by a Mack truck. You understand what I'm saying? If you die, they're going to say it's COVID-19. When in actuality, you know, many of these people who are dying have already, you know, they already had some kind of physical impairment, some kind of physical ailments internally, generally, right? Pulmonary, right? Or parasites, cancers, right? You know, kidneys, they're on kidney dialysis, or, you know what I mean? Diabetes, right? They got some kind of internal problems. A lot of people in these, so they say, in these nursing homes is that we know most of the people in nursing home getting ill care, but they also have some kind of physical impairments and some kind of disease or what have you, right? Again, Gerald Celente's been saying this for months now, talking about, you know, they you know, it's this is media driven, which it is. Like I said, they got a, you know, $1 billion propaganda campaign going on this, you know, media that they control, right? By wearing the mask, which is hurting people. Celente, we were watching him a few days ago, and he mentioned, read an article where, you know, people say they wearing this mask, they getting sick on the job, right? They getting, you know, feel faint and fainting and, you know, dizzy and just getting sick wearing that mask all the time. Now here last week, they talking about, you know what I'm saying, you should even wear the mask in the house, okay? See, because they know a lot of people are not wearing this mask like they want them to do, because they know this mask, as we read that documentation by Dr. Russell Blaylock here a couple of months back, right? Was that June? You follow what I'm saying? That mask is going to hurt you. I think it was June, May or June. That mask going to hurt you. You wearing that mask. But you can't tell these people anything. Like I said, they believe this government. I mean, and it's really astonishing in the movie, in a sense, right? But again, Yeshaya chapter 60, what does it say? The earth is in darkness and the people of the earth, what? In gross darkness. Okay? Because they believe this media propaganda driven by the illuminated Edomite that controls the multitude of the media that's coming across your TV, radio, newspapers. You understand what I'm saying? Daily. Right? Like I said, they only got like 6 media outlets in this country, and they're all controlled by the illuminated Edomite. It's probably more likely similar over there in Western Europe. But again, you got to remember, even though we see divisiveness, right, and these Illuminati, at least that's what I see, divisiveness amongst these illuminated members, you know, that control Russia, that can control China, right, control Europe, East and West, right, control America. You follow what I'm saying? They all are still illuminated. They all are still in opposition and in at war with Yah, Exodus 17, Numbers chapter 24. That's why Yah said, he's going to wipe them out, these illuminated Amalekite Edomites. So they don't want to see the way of Yah come on the scene. That they're in agreement with. See? Because they're going to fight against Yah until he wipes them out. So in regards to this pandemic, right, this so-called pandemic, you follow what I'm saying? They all in harmony with that. Because that is an attack on, definitely on Israel. See what I'm saying? Because in my mind, again, just like their mind was in the book of Hadassah, right? Esther, to totally wipe us out. Israel, totally wipe us out. Yah flipped it back on them. That's their mindset now. It hasn't just gotten like that. As I said in the past, right? What did Bertrand Russell say, Illuminati member, 28 years old in 1900, about 3 to 4 years after they saw us starting to awaken, right? When they knew the 2,000 years, 2 days, Hosea 6 had ended, right? And again, what do we see in the book of Daniel? Time and a half, right? You follow what I'm saying? And that's in one place. And in Daniel chapter 7, in regards to the little horn, which was Augustus Caesar, Octavian, time, and dividing of 10. See? But the times, time and a half, right? Over there in the first vision, right? That Daniel got, right? Be a time and a half. That's from what? That the first vision Daniel got was when? In the second year. you know, of Nebuchadnezzar. And again, that's 604 BCE. Right? That's 604 BCE. You follow what I'm saying? So, you know, from how they calculate in time, you know, we know they mess with time, right? So again, that's 604 and 2020 is what? I mean, that's 2,624 years, right? And so now, right, 2,500 years after that, right, after 604, would put you where? Huh? That's down there around the time, you know, when the seal came off the book, it, huh? Because we didn't talk about this before, right? That would be 2624, right, from 604. And here we are, 2020. And we started to awaken. This is the 124th year, is it not? From our starting to awaken, right? 1896, correct? Okay, so you 2624 and you subtract 124 from that, what you got? Pretty sure that's 2,500, isn't it? Time and a half. Do the math. Okay? So again, that's how real the word of Yah is. Right on the money. Right? And again, what did Yah say in Daniel chapter 12? I'll just read it, right? I stopped at verse, the part in the middle of verse 1. I mean, verse 1 in chapter 12, which again is continuation from 1136, right? And at that time, that people shall be delivered, everyone that shall be found written in the book. Quite naturally, we take on the names of our forefathers. We raise up those names. Resurrect, if you will, but we raise up those names. We connect, right? Isaiah chapter 44, right? Ezekiel 22, verse 17, correct? We take on our inheritance. As a brother just told me this morning, him and his wife, he said, you know, they're in Indiana. And he said to me, he said, yeah, elder, he said, we got our names changed. I said, right on. He said, yeah. He said, we really elated about that. He said, we thought we were going to have to go to the courthouse. He said, but they called us and did it over the phone. I said, they did. He said, yeah. I said, well, that's great. He said, yeah. I said, what, because of the COVID thing? He said, yeah. He said, but Ellie, he said, I don't think they wanted us to come to the courthouse. He said, they didn't want to see us. I said, okay, I can go for that. Okay? You follow what I'm saying? So, again, we take on our inheritance, right? Everyone that shall be found written in the book. That's where we see these names in the book of remembrance, so-called Old Testament. Right? That's what the Illuminated Edomite put on it, Old Testament. But when we look here at Malachi 3, 15 to the 18th verse, what did y'all say? He had a book of remembrance written up for those of us today who would think upon his name. Not only Israel, other people too. Because there's other people that know Yah is the Most High. That's not Israel. See? They was waiting on us. You understand what I'm saying? They were waiting on us. You know, it's different. You understand? Gentiles, pale faces, if you will, right? That found out who we were back there in the 50s, in the late 50s, coming into the 60s. And that was some of them, many of them was your flower child. You know what I mean? Peace, brother. Peace, sister. You know, like I said in the past, that's who Yah is talking about in Yeshua chapter 60 when he said, the sons, right? Daughters of those who have afflicted thee shall come bending. See? Because a lot of them, you understand, started to come to realize, you know, in the 60s, early said, they said, man, these are the Israelites. They can't tell us. That's why they was like peace in the way of the Most High. Peace. Yeshua 9:6, isn't that what the governor is called? The Prince of Peace? Because the way of Yah brings peace into this earth, you know, this world. And the world is in chaos, right? Because the illuminated Edomite has got it in a chaotic state. Didn't I just read that in verse 1 of the top of chapter 12? Time of trouble never been since it's been a nation. Novo ordo chao. New world order through chaos. So again, the plandemic, the attack. And this is not, you know, the beginning of the attack. He's been attacking for a while now. Long time. Like I said, he started attacking Israel when he saw it starting to awaken back in 1897 when he took the Theodore Herzl movement, the Zionist movement to the land. That's an attack on Yah, huh? And on Israel. Right? The Balfour Declaration, right? And put forth by the House of Rothschild. You understand what I'm saying? See? I mean, attack, you know, like I said in the past, that, you know, Bertrand Russell, 1900, we got to get ready to get rid of these useless Zetas, right? We've got to get ready to get rid of these useless Zetas. Doesn't that sound like Haman, the Amalekite, in the book of Hadassah, Esther, right? Him and the Amalekites that were with him, they drew up this plan to wipe out Israel. Yah flipped it back. On them through Mordecai and Hadassah, Esther, right? And they, where they've had planned to attack us on the Sabbath day, which was the 14th. Remember now, and from what we can see of the real calendar, every Sabbath day is always every seventh day, 7, 14, 21, 28 of every month. 7, 14, 21st, 28 of every month. Right? So they were going to attack us on the 14th day of the month. We attacked them on the 13th day and the 14th day and the 15th day. Right? Again, we had started attacking them on the 13th day. Right? That's when Haman, Haman got hanged. His 10 sons got hanged. Right? But also, that's when we attacked him on the 13th day. That's why, again, evidently, the illuminated Edomite over a period of time, they called, when they started calling the 6th day of the week, Freya's Day, right? You know, Freya, she's supposed to be, you know, the goddess in the chariot pulled by two pigs, two boars across the heavens, right? Freya, they named that 6th day of the week, Friday, after Freya, right? And so, you understand, they call Friday, what? The 13th, the bad luck day. You follow me? That's how that more likely came about. Because that's when Esau had to, you know, the ones that escaped, you know, they fled to Grecia, right? Because we know the whole Medo-Persian dominion, 127 provinces, right? The first chapter, the richest king ever, Xerxes Ahasuerus, right? First chapter of the book of Esther Hadassah, he's over 127 provinces. Right, and so the only way when the Edomites, when the hammer fell on them, that they was trying to wipe us out, if Yah flipped it back on them, the ones could run. Where did they run? They ran to Greece, who was in opposition. You know, who was at war with Medo-Persia, right? But the ones who couldn't run, then they had to do what? The book of Esther, right? Hadassah, chapter 8, back in, right? They said I'm not an Edomite. I'm an Israelite. And remember, Jew is an implant. The term Jew, that didn't even exist. We know that, right? Right? Because the letter J didn't even come into existence until after 1611 CEAD, in the midst of the 17th century. CEAD, that is centuries later. Oh, well, almost two, matter of fact, over, a little over two millennia later. Right? Because that what happened with, you understand, that I was saying to some people the other day. You follow what I'm saying? The book of Hadassah Esther opens up, first chapter, 483 BCE. It culminates in 473 BCE. Right? That's the book of Esther. Covers 10 years. Okay? You follow me? See? So, again, huh? Now, this illuminated Edomites, right? They got the same thing in their mind. Let's get rid of them. And again, they've been attacking since 1897 when they said took the Zionist movement to the land. See, now this is Israel here. Okay, these are the Israelites, the hypocrites, right? and they protect them and keep them there, right? As we see, right? And then what I say in what was that? The first 10, 11 years of the 20th century, they come up with the NAACP, right? The Urban League, right? These are attacks on us to try to make us think, oh, things getting better, right? But as we can see back then, right, they was lynching us, killing us. That still goes on today, huh? To this day, right? These Democracy Now! Shows I'm going to tell you about, look at the one yesterday on the 4th of August, 2020. And you'll see at the beginning, Amy Goodman's talking, and she's going to talk about this brother got killed. I miss where it happened, but they, you know, police were called to this store. They thought he was, you know, shoplifting. And even if he was, you'll see the police, they did the same thing to him they did to George Floyd. Killed him. And you'll see at the end, these policemen surrounded him, and one of the police got his foot on his back. They got him face down. He got his foot on his back. They said the brother was like, I can't breathe. One of the policemen told him, said, chill, because if you couldn't breathe, you couldn't say you couldn't breathe. You couldn't talk. And ended up killing him. Just like George Floyd. Okay? This has been going on for centuries. Millennia. Because it's the curse on Israel. And I don't care where Israel is. I don't care what the complexion, you know, is. You understand what I'm saying? Because we come in many colors, sizes, and disguises. But I have never seen of us go to the extreme pale. You know, Esau heard me say that some years back. And they supposedly brought this, you know, he was a pale face, but he claimed he was black. You understand what I'm saying? And it could have been his mother, might have been, you follow what I'm saying, an Israelite, maybe. But more likely than not, he had the features, you know, where he could have been an Edomite. But it's, again, you understand what I'm saying? Edomites, you know, some of them are dark-complected, like Farrakhan, like Lenny Kravitz, like Tracy Ellis Ross, like Berry Gordy. Edomites, but they dark-complected. See, that's why you can't go by color, right? Looks are deceiving. You got to go by nationality. And again, nationality is hard to, you know, recognize unless a person, you know, just like the Edomites did in, the Book of Hadassah chapter 8, right? More likely, you know, we were the same complexion back then. See, so the ones who couldn't run to Gresha, they could say, I'm an Israelite and get away with it. Like I said in the past, you know, probably from dress. You know, they dressed a certain way, like Israelites dress. And they can say, I ain't no Edomite, I'm an Israelite, and get away with it. See? Follow what I'm saying? Just like today, you understand? But you, as I said at the beginning of this again today, right? You cannot hide from Yah. Okay? You cannot deceive Yah. There is no offense or defense against Yah. I don't care who you are or who you think you are. And Yah is making this plainer and plainer every day now. Because he's setting up his kingdom. And he is very, very wroth, angry. Right? That's why he said in chapter 42, Yeshaya, huh? I've held my peace for a long time. Now I'm going to come out like a wailing, travailing woman. At once, right? And that's why we see now, again, Micah 7, verse 15, like according to the coming out of Egypt. Look what Yah is doing, right? Drying up the pools, the water, right? Bringing floods somewhere at the same time where it's drying up somewhere else. Bringing the locusts, the tornadoes, the hurricane. This hurricane now, they call it, In the media, right, they name it Isaias or Isaias, right? But it's really Yahshua. I mean, matter of fact, Yeshaya, right? It's really Yeshaya, Isaiah, Yeshaya. That's how it's pronounced. They gonna call it by the Greek terminology, like you see it possibly over, you know, in the Apocrypha. if you got one. See, as Esau again, you don't expect him to say Yeshaya, do you? Yeah, Yeshaya. You guys know what I mean? He say Esaias, Esaias. You know what I mean? That's how deceitful these people are, right? See, but again, it's Yahweh that brings the hurricane. He knows that without question. You follow what I'm saying? Okay? I mean, all these different things Yah is doing, right? Because it's a time of trouble, never been since it's been a nation. See? And bringing these nations into economic collapse through the sword. Again, Jeremiah 25, that he has brought and is bringing on the inhabitants of the earth. Because Yah moves the sword. They can't move unless he moves them. They can't do anything unless he allows it. You understand what I'm saying? You think they would not have killed off all Israel already if they could, if Yah had allowed it? They wanted to. You know they wanted to, but Yah has not allowed it. And he's never going to allow it. Quite naturally, it's Israelites that's dying. And these are Israelites who trying to be part of the iron. Like the one that just died that was up there in the House of Representatives for 17 terms, right? This Lewis, right? He's one of the House Israelites, House Negroes, you know, like Malcolm X used to talk about. For those of you who, you know, heard anything and knew anything about how Malcolm used to call these House Negroes, right? And that's what John Lewis was. You follow what I'm saying? He didn't know no better. Didn't want to know no better. I'm sure at some point he heard that we was Israel, but it was like bullets off of Superman. It didn't penetrate because he was all steeped in idolatry and steeped in the ways of the heathen, like most of these Israelites are. That's why you see them dying like they die. Huh? All kind of diseases. Isn't that in the curse, Deuteronomy 28, 15 through 67? Right? Isn't that what Yah says in Leviticus, you understand, what's that, 26th chapter? If we still refuse to hear, we still refuse to turn, we're going to be systematically destroyed in accordance with, you know, the desire of our heart in accordance to our ways. Jeremiah 17. It's all Yah, the hand of Yah. You see? See? You know, it's no getting away from it. Yah is setting up his dominion. And again, we see plenty of other people of other nationalities dying as well. Because Yah now, you understand? If you don't get in harmony with your creator, then you're in trouble. Okay? You're in trouble. And if you persist, I don't care who you are, who you think you are. If you persist in that adversarial stance against Yah's host and his way, see, then, you know, you're going to be systematically dealt with, and possibly, you know, you will, you know, if you sustain that consistent adversarial stance, he will destroy you in your ways. And in actuality, you'd be destroying yourself. Because everybody is you know, has a decision to make, and it's up to you on what you choose to do. See? And if you've heard this message in the past, or if you're hearing it now, right, then and you reject and you refuse to hear, you keep on going forwardly in the way of your own heart, then you're actually doing this to yourself. Okay? You know, because as this person just died here a few weeks ago, I went to his memorial. He was a Muslim. I used to think he was a Muslim when I first met him, but he wasn't. He didn't become a Muslim until 71. That's what is on his obituary. And when I went to his memorial, it was not in a mosque, it was not in a temple, it was not in a church. It, you know, they had a memorial for him in a banquet hall. So I went to represent Yah's host, because many of these people I've been knowing for years, okay? And they know me, and they know what and who I serve. They know, don't truly maybe understand it, okay? But they've seen, you know, when I was on the tube, those 4.5 years with Viewpoint, Mark Sims show, okay? And then, you know, as he was, different ones, you know, they at different times, and him more than many, because he used to cut my hair when he was barbering. And it was many times up in his place of business, you know, because he was also in the herbs, right? He was all, you know, the name of his business was Health is Wealth, right? He's about 4 years older than me, 3 to 4 years older than I am, right? But we, like I said, we've been knowing each other since like about 67, 68, okay? And he heard me have different conversations, you know, over the years in his shop with different people about the Most High, about Yah of Hosts. You know, one time in the early 90s, it was him and I in the shop. We was talking. I think somebody had been in there and they left. And, I, you know, something had come up and I was having a conversation with them. And then when they left, him, you know, we were talking and he said, man, I'm going to show you who God is. He went in the back, came out with this picture of Master Farad Muhammad. He said, this is who God is, you know, supposedly taught Elijah Muhammad. You understand? Because he was in the Nation of Islam. And I just laughed. I was like, yeah, really? He's like, yeah, that's who God is. I'm like, yeah, okay. You know, the same thing with them JC is like, you know, with John the Baptist and all that. You know what I mean? It's so, you know, comical. It's ridiculous, right? But, you know, it got to a place where, you know, it was conversations I was having with different ones that come up in this place because it was, you know, and it wasn't that I started the conversation per se. You know, it's just basically Yah started it some kind of way. Somebody would push a button on me. It might be a preacher come up in there, as, you know, it happened in the past, and, you know, handed me a sheet because he was cutting my hair, my man was. And this guy, preacher, came up into the shop with, protege, a young guy, and he handed me, reaching his briefcase, handed me this literature by JC. When I took a look at it, I handed it back to him. And so the preacher said to me, no, that's for you, man. I said, no, I'm not into idolatry. He like, what? And so, you know, that started a conversation, and he come quoting something to me. He had it all twisted, the preacher, right? I said, no, it doesn't say that. He like, oh, yeah. I said, no, it doesn't say that. And so my guy, you know, the Muslim, I said, where your book, man? He said, it's behind you, you know, up on the shelf. Because he had a Gideon's, a hardcover Gideon's, green cover. And so I reached up there and grabbed the book. I handed it to the preacher. I said, show me, you know, what you're talking about. So he fooled in the book for about a minute and a half, 2 minutes. He said, well, I can't find it right now. I said, let me have the book. So he gave me the book, and I went to where he, you understand, what he supposedly was talking about, and I showed it to him. I said, this is what you're talking about here. I said, but you had it all, you know, twisted up backwards. You know, you had it off. I said, but this is what you're talking about. And then he looked at me now with this, you know, dismayed look. You follow what I'm saying? Because now he knows, now he done messed around and hooked into somebody who's got knowledge of this book. See, because, see, these preachers and whatnot, even these so-called rabbis and mores and whatnot, and you understand what I mean? People who are in the Islam, yes, they think, you know, that, you know, they basically, when they come across people and get to talking, people don't have no knowledge of this Book of Remembrance. You follow what I'm saying? They don't even have knowledge of the Bible. Because again, the New Testament is totally, you know, inane. Nothing but garbage, as we've said time and time again here at Yah Righteousness. Concocted by the descendants of Esau, the illuminated Edomites coming up through time. As I told a person last night, you understand, she said, I said, you know, I was telling her this. I said, you know, she deals with a lot of these Israelites, been around these different Israelite groups. And I said, you know yourself, most of the Israelites that have awakened, they caught into Judaism and or Christianity. They cannot discern and differentiate the word of Yah from these two religions? And she said, yeah, I said, but, you know, like I just said before, anybody that says anything, you understand, that's supposed to be in this book of remembrance and or supposed to be the word of the Creator, if you understand, if you say anything like that around me, I'm going to take issue with it. You follow what I'm saying? You know, if you say anything that's supposed to be the word of the Creator, and you claiming it's the word of the Creator, I'm going to take issue with it if it's not right. You follow what I'm saying? If you say it around me, I'm gonna like, where is that? Because I haven't seen that. You can't just say anything and say that it's the Creator's word around me. See? Because Yah has blessed me from commitment and submission to Him through the years with giving me a good grasp of this book. Now, when I say that, I ain't saying I understand everything. Like I said to all of you in the past, I said to the brother this morning when he was talking about how these people, you know, you understand, he intimated about how, you know, he may not know everything. I said, you know, what's everything? Okay? Because Yah equates us as His trees, those of us who have turned to Him with all our heart and soul, His pleasant plants. He's creating His vineyard now of red wine. Yeshaya chapter 27. That's the Jerusalem movement. The vineyard of red wine. See? We're not going to be like them wild grapes our forefathers became. Right? When Yah started the vineyard that He talks about in Yeshaya. What's that? Chapter 5? Yeah, He planted a vineyard in the land but it to yield forth grapes, but it yielded forth wild grapes. Unruly. Adversarial to their creator, right? Well, the vineyard of red wine He's creating today, Yeshaya chapter 27, this vineyard is totally committed and submitted to Him, magnifying Him, you follow me, honoring Him, directing everybody to Him. Because again, that's the new covenant, is it not? Jeremiah 31:31 and on, you know, from 31st verse, chapter 31, Jeremiah, and on down. Everybody got to read this time. There is no excuse for nobody not knowing the will of Yah of hosts, their Creator. The only reason they don't know because they haven't desired to know. Simple as that. See? Yah is near, 51:5, Yeshaya, right? 46:13. He's near everybody. He's brought His righteousness near, which is His word. Genesis through Malachi, the book of remembrance, so-called Old Testament. That's what the Illuminated Edomites tagged it when they came up with the New Testament of the good spell writings of their idol that they put forth to the people, Yahushua or Jesus the Anointed. But again, what does Jesus, which means Yahushua, what does Yahushua mean? Huh? Yah's my help, my salvation, my deliverer. So it stands to reason you would go to Yah. Huh? Why would you go to somebody whose name means that Yah is His deliverer, His help, His salvation? So again, when I went to this memorial for this a brother who was a Muslim since 1971, you know, I'm sitting there, you know, everybody wearing a mask but me. And I ended up sitting with his youngest brother, the only one of his siblings that's alive. Because I found out through the obituary, he had four older brothers. And I would think the way, you know, it didn't say it, but my mind was these must have been his father's sons by his first wife, you know. But they're all dead. And so his father had him and his two younger brothers by, I guess, his second wife, right? And the only one left alive of his father's siblings, or should I say his father's sons, is my man's youngest brother, who I sat with at the memorial. Okay, and his younger brother is in real bad physical shape. As I saw that day, because I hadn't seen him in years. And I'm like, man, what's happened? He said, dude, I don't even want to dampen your day by telling you. But he was on a walker, and he's a year younger than me. Because he asked me, he's like, dude, how old are you? I said, 69. He's like, man, you're a year older than I am. But I sat there with him, and we talked. And then talking with him, he's like, you don't wear no mask. I said, man, it's all game. And after I talked, he took his off. And we sat there, you know, talking. You follow what I'm saying? It was good to see him. It wasn't good to see him in the shape, you know, he was in. But at the same time, I thought about, like, man, all of this man's sons are dead. There's only one left, and he's in bad physical shape. But like I said, they had the representative of Islam who talked, you know, about this man whose memorial was, like I said, who I've been knowing since 67 and 68. He talked from the Muslim perspective. Then, like the main speaker was a Christian, you know, who's married to my man who died, married to one of his nieces. And he's a preacher. And he spoke the longest, you know, and each one of them, the Muslim and the Christian, you know, every so often they were exalting their idol in some shape, form, or fashion, or as the Christian was, you know, as many of them do, they exalt the idol of Egypt. Amen. At the end, can I get an amen? But they don't even understand what they're saying. And I just sat there and observed and listened to all of this, you know, when they asked people to bow their head and pray, I didn't. I just sat there and listened and observed, okay, as an observer. But like I said, many of those who were there know me over the years, okay? Many of those who were there, or so many, I've had conversations with through the years. I know even more saw me on the tube for those 4.5 years at different times that we did sessions with Mark Sims that is on our website. So they know who I represent. They know who I advocate, who I promulgate. They know that, you know, I say that we're Israel, okay? And like I said, and the brother whose memorial was, again, he was supposed to have been in the health all these years. He had, he had an establishment called Health is Wealth. And then what did he die of? Again, 51:8 Yeshaya. And what does it say there? Like the moth eats wool, so the worm shall eat them up, the revilers. And remember what I said, you know, back in the early 90s, who, you know, he went back in the back and said, I'm going to show you who God is and brought this picture out of suppose this so-called person, Master Farad Muhammad. You follow me? Revilers. And it was a few times, you know, in the past where he mocked me, right? And one of the times, Yad and I were together, and he, you know, because we were at this restaurant, and it's not far from the house, and it was a Israelite brothers restaurant, you know, all vegetarian, and this is, I don't know, like maybe 2009, something like that, maybe, and we had gone to the restaurant on a Friday, and got something to eat. Might even been before 09, maybe 07. I can't remember, it's been so long, you know, 12, 13 years ago. And we didn't want to cook it summertime, so matter of fact, it wasn't even, you know, middle summer, it was like late. If I remember correctly, like late summer, you know what I'm saying? Something like September, okay? Where it starts getting dark at around, 7 o'clock. You follow what I'm saying? And, you know, but don't get completely dark until maybe around 7:20, something like that, right? And so I had picked Yada up from the train and, from work or whatever. I might even have gone down, picked up. We came back, you know, we don't cook, let's go on to the vegetarian restaurant. So we went there and ate, you know, and sitting there talking leisurely. Then, we looked, You know, it's getting, the sun had set. So Yada said, we better be getting out of here, Yada, Yoda, getting home. I said, yeah. So we were parked right in front. So as we went out and got in the car, my man and his wife, and I've been knowing his wife, you know, because she graduated a couple of years in front of me in high school. She, you know some other people I know. You know, we all come up the same community. Him and his wife came up. And like, hey, what's happening? I said, hey. So we were sitting there for a minute talking. And then he said, yeah, it's getting dark. And no, y'all going to turn into a vampire for long. Y'all better get home before it get dark. You turn into Dracula. You know, he's mocking, right? And like, we just, yeah, okay. So we left because, again, it's going to take about 10 minutes to get home. And, you know, so, you know, as I sat there observing and listening, you know, to the proceedings and whatnot, I thought about these things. And again, I had thought about it before, because when I got the word here, you know, around the end of 2018, the beginning of 2019, that he had prostate cancer, right? And then as time went by, like early 2019, I got the word he had stage 4 prostate cancer. And then I was like, okay, so when I see the people, they like, you hear about the brother? I said, yeah. So I say, hey, but, you know, he should know what to do. You follow what I'm saying? And I wasn't being facetious, per se. I mean, hey, he was in the health. He always used to talk about, you know, taking garlic and different herbs. And, you know, he used to tell people, you know, you can get pure blood. And I told him back then in the early 90s, one day it was just him and I in the shop and some people had come, and when they were leaving, he's like, yeah, this, you take this and give you pure blood. You know what I'm saying? So when the people left, I told him, I said, man, you need to stop telling people you can get pure blood. I said, can't nobody get pure blood now. Nobody on the face of the earth. I don't care what they do. They can't get pure blood now. We talked about it, but, you know, or at least I said that to him, you know what I mean? But I know he probably kept on saying to people what he was saying. But again, the proof is in the pudding, right? How did he leave here? And from what I understand, I was told that, because when, my guy called me and gave me the, where the memorial was and the time, because it was on a Sunday, because we had talked and, he said, well, when I find out, I'll call you and let you know. He said, because his brother was real tight with the person who died's wife. You know, they were in the same class together. So he said, when I get, the proceeding, I'll call and let you know. You know, I said, yeah, let me know, because if it's, not on the Sabbath, I can go. As long as it's not in the church or anything like that, right? So he called me and told me, he said, yeah, man, it's at this banquet hall out in the south suburbs, and it's on Sunday at noon. So I'm like, okay, cool. And I mean, it rained. It was real stormy and everything. Do you know, I went, didn't get wet. I mean, just a little water on my arm. You know, when I got out at the banquet hall, I was able to park right in front, had my umbrella, didn't get wet. But it's storm. You're talking about a storm. I mean, it's storm. Okay, and it still had a nice turnout. But then, as we were there, because I left after about 2.5, 2 hours, 40 minutes, but when they started eating, right, because, and they all wearing masks. It was only one other person that came, about maybe 50 minutes before I left. It was a sister. She didn't have a mask on. You know, she might have been in her 30s, but she didn't have masks. We were the only two that didn't have masks. Everybody else wearing a mask. But now when they sit down to eat, the mask got to come down, right? And I'm standing there kind of looking at them, they pulling the mask down to eat, right? And they like, ain't you going to eat? I'm gone. You know what I mean? I'm getting ready to leave. You know what I'm saying? But, you think people would stop and consider. And I know some did to whatever degree, okay? And if they didn't really think about it, then they gonna think about it later. Cause one brother that was there, he talked, got up and talked, at the podium about the brother who passed, and we saw each other, later on. And because he had that mask on, I didn't really recognize him when he was talking. And then when later on I saw him coming out of the restroom, and he had the mask off, and I like, he said, "Hey man," I said, "Hey man, what's happening?" So then I'm like, "Oh, okay," you know. I said, "I didn't recognize you when you had that mask." He said, "Yeah." So we talked a little bit, and he said, "Like, so what's been happening?" So I reached in my pocket, gave him a card, right? And I said, "You know, that's, you know what we do." He said, "Yeah," because him and I've had conversations in the past. And I said, "Here's a card, you know, website's on the back." He like, "Oh, okay." You see what I'm saying? But again, this brother, I was told, you know, that he went the last like year and a half incognito. You know, nobody saw him. He didn't want to see anybody. I was told some people tried to see him. He wouldn't see him. Because my man, when he called, he'd tell me where, you know, the memorial was and give me all the particulars. He said, "Yeah." He said, I said, "So what is it a open casket or something?" He said, "No, man, he said, don't say." He said, "But I'm pretty sure they cremated him." I said, "Oh, okay." He said, "Yeah, you know, he didn't want to see nobody when he, you know, the last year and a half, he didn't want nobody seeing his corpse." I said, "What you mean?" He said, "You know, he was hiding." I said, "What you mean hiding?" He said, "Well, you know, he didn't see nobody." He said, "This, you know, people tried to see him, he wouldn't see nobody." He said, "And the word I got is like he got all the way down to like 110 pounds." I said, "Oh, okay." You know, and I know this brother, you know, when he was alive, had to be weighing around 210, 220, right? But he lost about half his weight. So again, 51:8, Yeshaya, like the moth eats wool, right? So shall the worm eat up the revilers, the mockers. And again, as I was having this conversation with somebody just here yesterday, you know, and the way the conversation, you know, I said, "Yeah, what does it say? Be not a mocker." You know what I'm saying? Because he was telling about how some of these people talk to him. I said, "Yeah, but what does it say? Be not a mocker, lest your bands be made strong." Right? Right? In that 51:8, for the moth, let me read verse 7 in 51st chapter, Yeshaya. "Hearken unto me, ye that know righteousness." You hear that? You that know righteousness, which is Genesis through Malachi, right? The word of Yah, right? The people in whose heart is my law. Yah's law, statutes, orders, judgments, commandments, and precepts, right? "Fear ye not the reproach of men, neither be ye afraid of their revilings," their mocking, right? Their opposition, their adversarial stance, right? To Yah, their creator, right? Because they're in idolatries, whatever those idolatries are. And what does it say, verse 8? "For the moth shall eat them up like a garment, and the worm shall eat them like wool. But my righteousness shall be forever, and my salvation from generation to generation." See? And that's the everlasting life, right? From generation to generation. Right? Again, what did y'all say to Abraham in Genesis 15? "I'm going to multiply your seed like the stars of heaven." What does it say in Genesis chapter 26? "Y'all knew that Abraham would teach his children his laws, his commandments, his statutes, his ordinances." See? You know, like I said last year, right? When Yaakov and Yahadasa brought this to me about the Urim and the Thummim, that got us to talking. And they, Yah had let them see it. And then through them, Yah conveyed it and illuminated me, right? And then from them illuminating me, you know, or should I say Yah illuminating me through them, right? And then bringing this to me. Then, as it says in Proverbs, what does Solomon say? "Iron sharpens iron." Yah sharpened me. And then I could even see even more. I could see even in greater depth. Right? And it's reciprocity, it's back and forth, right? And that's, you know, that's from Yah, right? And again, we see that Isaac, as they told me, you know, it wasn't Isaac that was off, because I'm going from how Isaac got off later, but at the outset when Yah brought Rebekah to him, right? And 20 years before Yah impregnated her, right, with the twins, Esau and Jacob, right? But why does, I'm looking at it because Isaac was off. It took so long. But like they brought to me, no, Yehuda, it wasn't Isaac that was off then. It was Rebekah. She coming from the house of idolatry. As soon as they say, I said, you know what, that's absolutely, I'm in absolute agreement with you. That's right. She came from the house of idolatry. It took her 20 years to get in harmony with Yah. And then Yah impregnated her. See? But we see later on, Isaac got off. That's why Yah was taking his sight. Like Yosha brought to me, you follow me? It probably was a diabetic. You understand? Blindness to the degree he couldn't see because he was eating that meat, probably eating the fat with it, which we're not supposed to eat the fat. See? Right? And for those of you out there, that, you know what I mean? I mean, I had a great uncle. I mentioned him in the past time, right? He was a preacher and whatnot. But I had a great uncle. He ate that swine, that fat back, because he loved navy beans. And he ate that fat back with them navy beans all the time. I mean, and it ain't nothing but a block of fat. You basically, see? So, you know, but as we talked and discussed it, Yaakov and Yahadasa and myself, Isaac, after the blessing went down, Isaac, more likely than not, had a back and forth with Rebecca. Huh? Because, you know, again, you know, she messed up when she got ahead of Yah and got Yaakov to lie and deceive his father. He got that back later. You know, we didn't talk about that. See? That's why, you know, a lot of them boys that he had this junk in them because of the acrimony that he was exhibiting toward Leah, their mother, right? And more than likely the jealousy between Leah and mostly coming from Rachel, from, you understand, to Leah. You follow what I'm saying? That's why you're not supposed to take two sisters to wife, right? And Yaakov knew that, but he wanted Rachel. He would have been deceived, like he deceived his father. He had been deceived into taking Leah. You follow what I'm saying? He didn't want her. But when he knew the law, but after he had been deceived, like he deceived his father 7 years earlier, then he went on and took Rachel anyway, which caused more problems, exacerbated the problem. But it, as I said before, you understand, it had to be, it wasn't until, you follow me, after the birth of Lewi, and before the inception of Yahuda, that Yaakov humbled himself and acknowledged his wrong. Because again, most people went wrong. When something adverse happens to them, they won't blame somebody else. And that's what we see with this BLM, all this Black Lives Matter. They're out there protesting. And the Caucasians is out there protesting. And other protest groups, they want to blame somebody else for their situation when it's they're the reason why these things are happening to them. Because they're not in harmony with their creator. I don't care where you are on the face of the earth. I don't care who you are, who you think you are. Adversity is happening to you. You got problems, physical, you understand what I'm saying? Mental or economical, right? Geographically, you know, whatever, you understand what I'm saying? You got problems. It's because you're not about your creator, Yahav Host. It's nobody else's fault but your own. Now, quite naturally, again, you read me 25, Yah has said what? I'm going to bring a sword on the inhabitants of the earth. Again, Genesis chapter 27. We know who the sword bearer is. That's the Edomites. Isn't that what Isaac told Esau? You understand? You're going to have the fatness of the earth and the dew of heaven also. But you got to serve your brother. But it's going to come a time when you're going to be able to break your brother's yoke off your neck. That can only happen when Israel turned away from Yah and stopped serving Yah with all their heart and soul. Then Esau, as we see in Chronicles and Kings, you know, the book of the governors, you know what I'm saying? It came a time when Esau rose up and broke, you know, came out from up under the dominion of Yahuda. And Jerusalem, you know what I mean, out from under the dominion of Israel. See, but it was a long time later before Esau got to the point where they got the dominion on the earth, right? Because now they've only had the dominion on the earth a little over a century. Total dominion. And it's a diversified dominion amongst the illuminated members, the core, the cabal. Okay? See? But what it, as I said in the past, we know what Isaac had to tell him, though, but your dominion is not going to last. You're going to come back up under your brother forever. And that'll be under the dominion of Yahweh, the king. See? The Esau, when he translated the book, they took that out of there. We know Isaac had to tell him that. You understand what I'm saying? But they took that out. And again, that's, you know, that's why the original Esau hated his blessing. Huh? See what I'm saying? So, you know, now it's coming full circle. See? The illuminated Edomites, they're trying to control Jerusalem. Right? That's why May 2018, they actually, the daughter of Babylon actually set their embassy in Jerusalem. So they're sitting in the sides of the north. Yeshaya chapter 4:10. Right? See? Because, you know, that's the snake now. It's coming all the way back around to Jerusalem. Like I read you in the protocol last session. Right? And the snake now is trying to set up in Jerusalem and control Jerusalem. But they know that's the key. See? But now, Yah, again, as he said, you understand, in Daniel chapter 2, in the days of these kings, when they mingling seed, and they doing that across the board, and I got an article in the stash I'm going to read later, you understand, some things that Yaakov and Yahadasah brought to me here about 6, 7, 8 months ago, okay? And we talked about it, but I got an article about it in the stash, okay? Okay, I'm going to talk about that later. But you follow what I'm saying? Yah is setting up his kingdom in these days when they mingling seed, and they doing that across the board, these illuminated Edomites. Like I said, these people don't know what they've been getting shot up with the last 50, 60, 70 years. I mean, look what they was doing to the Israelite brothers, and I know they was doing it to the sisters too, huh? You follow what I'm saying? In that Tuskegee experiment, inseminating syphilis into us. And when it got, you know, revealed here, they took it and went down, what was that, Guatemala? It was Honduras or Guatemala. They took it down there and kept on doing it. You follow what I'm saying? Here the other day, we were looking at Max Kaiser and Stacey Herbert. Stacey Herbert was talking about, you know, Tuesdays, yesterday, as a matter of fact, Max Kaiser, Tuesday, right, August the 4th, right, and Stacey Herbert was talking about MK Ultra. You follow me? The experiment that they're doing up in here in this daughter of Babylon with many of us Israelites, right, and more likely they probably was doing it on some Caucasians, pale faces, Gentiles too, but they definitely was doing on Israel. I saw this, and I may mention of this in the past. I saw this on a 60 Minutes special years ago, and they showed this Israelite brother that they just messed his mind totally up. He didn't even know he was in the world. They've been giving him that LSD in this MK Ultra. And like I said, this, man, I saw this back in like the 80s. I think it was the 80s. Early 80s, maybe middle 80s, right? Okay, and so she was talking about this MK Ultra, mind control. See? And, you know, again, this is what we see. Every time I see, you know, people wearing a mask, I know they're under mind control. Simple as that. Okay, because again, like I said, Gerald Celente was talking about it here last week or earlier this week. You follow me? Matter of fact, I think it was Monday we watched this. Gerald Celente, he read one of his articles in his session where he was saying that mask is going to come out. People is, you know, this mask is impairing people, hurting people. Matter of fact, on Peter LaVelle today, y'all had it on before we started this session. And he had this sister named Cross that's on Watching the Hawks on RT. She's on there. And he had this other brother. I can't remember his name. Young brother. But, you know, he's suited up with his tie and stuff. But he made mention how these masks, he ain't for wearing these masks. These masks, you know, talking about wearing these masks like 24/7. The mask is not good. See? And it's not. You know, I told some of these people, you know, that I knew at the memorial for this brother here the other week, you know, Sunday before last. You know, because they were like, you don't wear no mask, yo. No, that mask is game. This is all game. But they couldn't hear it. You know, at least, you know, maybe to resonate on some of them I talked to later on. But, you know, they really couldn't, you know, like my man's brother, like I said, he took his mask off. We talked. But, you know, he just took his off. He's like, you ain't wearing, I ain't wearing one either. And he didn't put it back on, not while I was there. Okay? But, like I say, you know, they can't hear. They can't, you know. But like I said to someone when they was getting ready to eat, they're like, you're not going to eat Yoda? I'm like, nah, I'm all right. I'm getting ready to go anyway. Okay? But I was, you know, they was sitting down and they got the mask on. Okay, so how y'all going to eat? You got to take the mask off, don't you? So you not worried about getting, you know, COVID-19? You know what I mean? You see what I'm saying? It don't make any sense. See, now here the last week, they've been saying, putting out, you should wear the mask even in the house. That's how much Esau know he wants you to wear this mask. Because he know that mask going to hurt you. And they want to get rid of people. And they definitely want to get rid of Israel. See? Because they watch the session. They hear. They see the illumination Yah's giving out. Okay? You follow me? They see it happening. And they getting crazy and crazy and crazy every second of every day. And I'm sure, you know, these monarchies and other people of stature, knowledgeable people, they see it. Man, they gone nuts. Okay? But isn't that what Yah said? Huh? In the one chapter of Bible, he was going to take the wisdom and understanding out of the Mount of Esau. That's all of them. Young or old, male or female. Right? And then, in the 51st chapter of Yeshaya, what did he say? Huh? I'll read it to you, because I'm right here, right? Because he's saying, I'm going to pick this up at verse 17, 51st chapter of Yeshaya. Awake, awake, stand up, O Jerusalem, which has drunk at the hand of Yah the cup of his fury. You have drunken the dregs of the cup of trembling and run them out. Because, you know, it's a double curse on the descendants of Jerusalem for what, you know, our forefathers eventually did. Turned away from Yah, like it says in Ezekiel 16, right, 59 through 63. What did Yah say? I'm going to deal with you, you know, deal with you in a way, you understand, because of what your fathers did in despising the oath, you understand, and breaking the covenant that he made with Jerusalem, specifically, see? So what is Yah saying there, as I've said in the past, right? He's purging out any and everybody away from the Jerusalem movement that's not totally committed and submitted to him. Right? Because again, you look at the situation, as I said here in the last so many months, since, you know, Yah has moved the sword to attack mankind with this pandemic. Right? Again, all of these people who are out here, right, who, you understand, got their illusions of possibility. Deluded, Yeshaya chapter 66, right? In their illusions of possibility, right? Following the imaginations of their own heart. They've chosen their own ways. And what is Yah saying? He definitely talking about Israel there, but it's applicable to other people too. Huh? He going to choose their what? Delusions. Now with this pandemic that Yah has moved, huh, the sword to attack, right? Mankind with this pandemic. Now, and with these shutdowns, right, and with this economic collapse that was already up and running before the pandemic, right? You follow what I'm saying? All of these illusions of grandeur, huh? Illusions of possibility, these the delusions that people had in their heart, right? It the screen has gone black. They don't see it, you know, it's black in front of them now. You understand? Like I said, I had people calling, Yahuda, what's going on? What is really happening? You know what I mean? People who not even about Yah. But no, I am. who've watched, you know, some of the sessions in with Mark Sims, and more likely than not, as I've said in the past, you know, I know they go on the internet, bring up Yah Righteous, and listen to some of the things that's being said. You know, and you know what the response was through the years. Oh, man, Yehuda, you know, he's been talking about this stuff for years, man. Yes, Dad, you know, and again, in that Amos 9:9, huh? Matter of fact, Amos, what's that? Amos 9:10? No, Amos 9:9. You know, what does it say there? That Yah said that many Israel were going to say, man, but you know, it's not only Israel, there's other people too, not Israelites. They hear this, and it, through the years, they're like, oh, man, what he talking about, it's not going to overtake us. That's not going to happen in our lifetime. Huh? And then you get others like, yeah, you hear what that Yehuda talking about, you hear what that Yah Righteous talking about, you know that Yah Righteousness guy, you follow me? Some of them say that Yahweh Yah Righteous, you know what I mean? They don't even know how to pronounce the name of the Most High. You follow what I'm saying? Hey, you hear what he talking about? Yeah, you know, that ain't going to stop me from dealing with Christmas and Labor Day and 4th of July. It ain't going to stop me from dealing with birthdays. Huh? You know that I don't care what he talking about. I'm gonna keep on drinking cow's milk. That's why you see these people walking around weighing 300, 400, 500 pounds. Look like some of them so big they can't hardly walk, waddle, huh? Like if they fall over, like they have a hard time getting up, right? Drinking cow's milk and eating all kind of unclean things. Ain't gonna stop me what he talking about. Me eating chicken and turkey and chicken eggs. He don't know what he talking about, huh? Catfish, right? Pig, they ain't gonna stop me. Tuna fish, they ain't gonna stop me from me. He don't know what he talking about. See, just like my guy that just died, 73 years old. Like I say, his establishment was called Health is Wealth. He's selling herbs. One of the brothers that I met through him back in 1990 or 91, about 30 years ago, he down in Georgia. He said, yeah, he said, Israel, you know, but he had a lot of knowledge. I said, yeah, but he had some knowledge. Because he said, well, he told a lot of people about them herbs. I said, yeah, he told people about herbs. I said, but how did he die? I pointed this out to him the other week when we was on the phone. He called on the Sabbath. We was talking. And I took him to this 51:7-8 verse in Yeshaya that I just read. I said, you see that there? Because this brother know now, he know we Israel. So he read. See what I'm saying? But he's kind of, you know, he's at the, you know, he's just getting his legs up under him, so to speak. He's a novice. See? And so I said, you see what it say there? Okay? I said, and how did he die? You understand? Prostate cancer, the worm, parasites, eating his insides up like the moth eats wool. He like, Okay. I said, you see how real this book is? The word of Yah is? See? Follow what I'm saying? See? So again, he had some knowledge, but he had no wisdom at all. Because again, when you read the first 9 chapters of Proverbs, what does the wisest man ever would be say? Huh? The beginning of understanding is the knowledge of the Most Holy. Now that's the beginning of knowledge. Right? Right? But then what does it say over there in chapter 8, chapter 9, when Solomon gets to talking like he's wisdom, you know, he's talking about wisdom, right? This is wisdom talking, but it's Solomon talking, but it's Yah bringing the wisdom through Solomon. And it's like wisdom's talking, right? And what did, you understand, what did Solomon say in regards, in the, you know, he's wisdom, you understand, talking like in the place of wisdom. He say wisdom is talking, right? Yah had me, possessed me at the beginning, before he created the earth, before he created the heavens, huh? Before he created anything, Yah brought me forth, wisdom. Now that's your light over there in Genesis chapter 1. See, it might have said wisdom in the original book, but Esau changed it to light with his deceitful self. But again, wisdom is light. And isn't that what Moshe told children of Israel in Deuteronomy? When Yah told Moshe, give them the law one more time before you die, before they cross over, you understand, into the land of Canaan. Give them this law one more time. And what did Moshe say? Huh? You understand? This is not a vain or worthless thing unto you, O Israel. This is your wisdom and understanding in the sight of these nations. Huh? And by the keeping of these laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts of Yah, your days shall be multiplied. Your days shall be prolonged. See? That's why I wanted them to see me at that memorial. Now here he is. You understand? He in idolatry. Right? All of them that was there was in idolatry. But many of them that were there know I advocate and promulgate Yah of hosts. See? And we all around the same age. Ain't that much different, 3 to 4 years. Because most of them there, you understand, that were there. I'm older than. There's just a few of them that was older than me. But we still all around the same age. See? Another brother that was there, he only came. He's older than me. He was the one that was in the class with my man who died, wife. You follow what I'm saying? They 2 years in front of me. You understand? He's there. He owned the cane. See? He going getting treatments. He said, showed me this this chamber, this, what they call it, barrack chamber. They put him in and he's supposed to feed him oxygen. And he talking about, you know, he's getting better, but he's shaking on his limb. You know, and he showed me this, you know, I didn't ask this, but he just wanted to show it. Oh, okay, all right. You know, but he didn't push no buttons on me, so hey, it wasn't no tune I could give him. You understand? Because he didn't push no buttons. Okay, you put yourself in the hands of man. Because he told me he already had like 40 something treatments, some kind of chamber, the barometer chamber or something. You understand? He showed it to me. It's like, you know, like something out of Forbidden Planet or something out of, you know, out of space. You know, he getting in the thing and they seal him up in there and supposed to be feeding his body oxygen. He said he can tell the difference. He getting better where he ain't as shaky and he can walk, but he's still on that cane. You know what I'm saying? All right, you know, okay. What can I say? Right. He didn't ask me what I thought about it. He didn't ask me, you understand what I mean? Was there anything he thought I should, you know, that I thought he should do? He's like, okay. All right. I just like, okay. You follow what I'm saying? But he put himself in the hands of man. See? And just here, last few days, I, you know, had conversations with 2 different people. And as a matter of fact, 3, 4 different people. And that came up about Asa. Right, but these people I had conversations with, they in the book. You dig what I'm saying? They in pursuit of Yah. You understand what I'm saying? And just because I had a conversation with, I brought up Asa, right? And those of you who knowledgeable in the book, right? He was one of the governors of Yahudah, was he not? He was about Yah, like the first, what, 38, 39 years? Now, those of you who might not know what I'm talking about, go in and read about Asa. He was about 38, 39 years. And then he started to what? When he got confronted with this force that was coming against him, he trusted in flesh and went to flesh. You know, and Yah delivered, you understand, him and Yahuda, Benjamin, Jerusalem. But what did Yah send the prophet to tell him? Since you trusted in flesh, now you're going to have wars. He got upset, smote the prophet, didn't kill him, but like hit him. And if I'm not mistaken, put him in prison. You understand what I mean? And then what did Yah do to Asa? Huh? Like in his 40th year. He diseased him in his feet. Now, as we was talking here the last, you know, few conversations I've had the last few days about it, because it's somehow these conversations, Yah, you know, control these conversations with different people. But this kind of comes back, you know, it comes up with different people. You see what I'm saying? The way the conversations went. Right? It's Yah that controls these conversations, right? Just like he's hopefully always, you know, I hope he's, you know, bringing this one forth to for all of you out there to hear what he wants you to hear, right? And again, Asa had been about Yah for like about 38, 39 years, and then he messed up. And instead of acknowledging when Yah brought it to him, humbling himself, he went the other way. Huh? He became adversarial. He got angry at Yah. How much sense does that make? He got angry at Yah. Right? Smote the prophet, put him in prison. Right? And then Yah started to disease him in his feet. Now, you know, at the outset of this disease, it didn't automatically go to the, you know, extreme immediately. It started. Because this is the anger of Yah. Huh? Yah's putting in his feet, diseasing him. And instead of him turning to Yah, humbling himself, he, what does it say? He turned to flesh. He turned to the physicians, like most people do today. Isn't that right? And I do mean most across the face of this earth, right? They turn to flesh, to the medical industrial complex, right? And like I was having this conversation this past Sabbath, and I'm like, you know, Yada and I were talking. And I'm like, how can these people, you understand, put faith and trust in this government, in this medical industrial complex? Huh? How can they do it? What's the symbol of the medical industrial complex? Isn't it a snake wrapped around, look like a staff or a sword? Huh? Yes, that a big, because we were supposed to look up, still didn't do it. Maybe on the Q&A we would have looked it up. The names they give for that staff or whatever it's called, it's like a Greek name. You follow what I'm saying? They got a Greek and Latin name for it. Okay, and y'all say we're going to look it up. We ain't got to look it up yet. Maybe we'll do it on before the Q&A, and I'll talk about it on the Q&A. You follow what I'm saying? But it's a snake. Huh? A snake. And as I mentioned it to this brother the other day out on the East Coast, he said, yeah, he said, you know, you the, and because he had brought this to me here some months back about you. He called one day, he's like, you the man, I, you know, what do you think about this? Moses supposed to made a snake of brass, put it on a pole, and everybody who looked on it lived. I said, well, you know, I'm pretty sure I said in the past, I don't know about that. He said, that don't make no sense, Yoda. How's that uplifting y'all? I said, you're absolutely correct. You understand what I'm saying? See, now they predicate this medical, you understand, establishment, right, on that. That's, he told me, he said, they predicated on that. See, that's some of Esau's mess. And Moses ain't, y'all ain't told him to put, make no snake of brass and put it on no pole, and everybody who looking on is going to live. That's Esau's junk. See, this is what happens with, you know, when you actually get your mind around on the word of Yah, his righteousness, Genesis through Malachi. And the more you get, you understand, as I said to some over this past few days, you know, it's like, you understand, Yah said we like trees, right? And so when you, you know, they take a tree that's real old and they cut it in half and you can see the rings, right? Because I wasn't settled in Yadida, we was talking about it on this last Sabbath. I said, you know, because Cody was on the phone, three of us was talking, and I said, you know, how many years does each one of those rings in the, you know, inside the tree represent? So Yada heard, she was sitting there, so she looked at, she said it just represents 1 year. So I'm like, oh, okay, because I was thinking each ring inside the tree represented more than 1 year, but it just represents a year. Right? Okay, so as the tree grows, because as I was saying to them, you follow me, I've seen trees. We got some trees right outside the house here down, you know, across the alley that they, I saw them plant when they, you know, first planted them. And when they first planted those trees, you know, over the years, you know, when the trees first started coming up, you know, a child could go pull it up with his hand. When the trees got a little bit bigger, you know, like maybe 4 or 5 feet high, I saw some of the children come by and break off some of the branches. You know, they might even bend the tree, but the tree straightened back up and keep on growing. right? Now, years later, and I'm talking about, it's been now about 20 years or close to it, maybe not quite 20, maybe 18, something like that. Now you look at those trees, they big, they beautiful. You know, a truck could hit them. Tree ain't going nowhere. You follow me? Because it's gotten stronger and stronger, and its base is grown. The, you know, branches is grown. Like I say, they real pretty, right? And that's what Yah equates us as. You see what I'm saying? And as we get older and in pursuit of Yah, and the more we read, the more we study, the more we pray to Yah for wisdom and understanding and whatever else, right? The more we do, the more we, you understand, learn how to keep Yah first at all times. You follow what I'm saying? Because we got his law in our heart. You follow what I'm saying? The law in our mind, right? Whenever something happens, we take it to Yah. You know, that's repetitious, right? We become repetitious with this. You know what I'm saying? Because Yah's been preparing us for the time to come. It's always he's preparing us for the time to come. Just like I said about those monarchies when they got sprinkled with the publication back in 2004 September. Now he's been preparing them for the time to come. And that time to come where Yah's going to bring them to his arm, to his movement. Again, Daniel 7 verse 13, Yeshaya chapter 60, what does it say? And the king shall come to the brightness of thy rising. Well, the movement of Yah, huh? He lifts his arm up from the midst of her, the daughter of Babylon. Yeshaya chapter 52. Okay? That's where the movement is established, in the midst of the daughter of Babylon. And the daughter of Babylon is the United States of America. Jeremiah chapter 50, 51. Yeshaya chapter 47. Huh? Yeshaya chapter 48, verse 9. The furnace of affliction. This daughter of Babylon, this United States of America. Okay? Because again, this is where the illuminated Edomite came, right? And actually established the Ephah, Zechariah chapter 5. The basket with all the imaginations of his heart in it. Demos Crossi, huh? You follow what I'm saying? All kind of religions, right? The economic imaginations, you know, with the stock markets and the bonds market and the money markets and the pensions. You follow me? All kind of game, right? You understand what I'm saying? He just exhausted all the measures of his heart, and it comes out of, you know, this daughter of Babylon, which is the cup. You know, the Ephah is the cup, the basket. You know, again, you remember 25, that Yah is taken to all the nations, right? And they drink of the cup, which again is basically the adversarial stance against Yah. And again, it didn't originate here. You follow what I'm saying? Because it started with Jerusalem when they started going in idolatry. And that's back with, again, when, you know, they started going in idolatry, again, being like a teenager, wild, unruly, the wild grapes, right? And you understand? And, you know, because they were a child when Yah brought them out of Egypt, Hosea 11, 1, right? And again, idolatries, that's what Jerusalem went into. And and when they saw the people going into it, they went into it and condoned what the people was doing. That's why it's a double curse on the descendants of Jerusalem. Jerusalem was the first one to drink of the cup of idolatry and obstinacy and adversarialness against Yah. Because it's the elders of that, you know, again, Jerusalem is first in Israel, right? Because that's the everlasting covenant. You know, Yah made a special covenant with the descendants of Jerusalem when he created Jerusalem, when he brought Israel out of Egypt, Ezekiel 16th chapter. See? But we see again in Ezekiel 23, huh, when the two sisters was down in Egypt, that's when they totally lost their virginity. In their being, you know, pubic years, right? Was it the puberty, right? Like, you know, 12, 13 years old. That's when they totally lost their virginity, right? When they came back into the land of Canaan, you understand what I'm saying, as a nation, you know, a populous and populous, right? A teenager. But now they've been, you know, laying with, you know, idols and images, creating fornication with idols and images, all down into Egypt. Already had started before they went down into Egypt. Isn't that right? Isn't that what Yah's telling Abraham in Genesis chapter 15? Because I'm going to bring them back here to the land of Canaan, right? Because the iniquity of the Amorite is not yet fulfilled. Because we see, you understand, Israel, ten older brothers of Yahusha, right? And their families going in idolatry. That's why Dinah was raped out there, you know, running around with the Canaanite girls, young girls, who's in idolatry. That's why she got raped, because she's going in idolatry. So Yah wasn't her strength and shield. You follow me? See, that's why the 10 older brothers of Yahusha didn't want him around, because he totally about keeping the law. They not. Some more than others, you understand, picking and choosing, but none of the 10 older brothers were about totally committed and submitted to Yah, keeping the laws and statutes or the judgments of Yah. Yahusha was. That's why they didn't want him around. And that's why, you understand, you know, they hated him, some more than others, right? Reuben didn't necessarily like him, but he didn't want to kill him. He kept him from the other ones killing him straight out. But when Reuben left the scene, and now they just talk again, let's kill him, right? And then it was Yahuda who didn't want to kill him, right? You understand what I'm saying? So he saved him. Again, Deuteronomy 33. That's why Moshe, what he said about Yahuda, hear Yahuda, Yah, and deliver him from his enemies. Because that's what Yahuda did with Yahusha when Yahusha was in the pit. He heard the cries of Yahusha. And when he heard his two older brothers, because he was the fourth oldest, right? When he heard Simeon and Levi, the ring leaders, and wanted to kill him, and then them boys out of Bilhah and Zilpah, they hated, they wanted to kill him, and he kept hearing this. So the only way he could supersede his two older brothers who was older than him, you understand? Okay, what profit is this? We kill him. Let's sell it, make a little money. And they went for that. Oh, okay. That's how Yah delivered him. You understand? But this come from Yahuda. So he didn't want to kill him. He didn't necessarily, you know, he wasn't totally committed and submitted to Yah either. But Yahuda had, like Reuben, had a sense of rightness. You understand? Like we see later on, what did Reuben say? When Yahusha had himself disguised and was dropping this drama on him, what did Reuben say? See, I told you not to kill the boy. This is coming back on his recompense. See? And didn't Yahusha hear Reuben saying this to him? Then he knew Reuben wasn't. You understand? He knew unequivocally. Reuben wasn't for this. See what I'm saying? So like I say, now we know that's why he kept Simeon there and had him bound before the other nine before he sent them back, right? He had Simeon bound right before him because he's Simeon, the ringleader. You see how Yah has exposed this in the last like year and a half? He brought all this more illumination. This more understanding. These are the things, more likely without a doubt, are in the original book, see, that Esau obscured, obfuscated. Why? Because he don't want us to understand. You follow what I'm saying? The path of redemption. See? He doesn't want us to understand the mercy of Yah. Again, what does Yah say in the 57th chapter of Yeshaya? I do it with the contrite and humble spirit. To revive the spirit of the humble in the heart of the contrite. You can't be contrite unless you sin. What did the wisest man ever would be say? In his supplication after the completion of the first temple, right? 1 Kings 8, 2 Chronicles 6. There is nobody that does good and sins not. You follow me? That's why Yah created the order of the priesthood, and took the Levites for killing the firstborn man and beast of Egypt. And then, you understand, at the behest of the children of Israel, who consecrated the Levites to Yah for killing the firstborn man and beast of Egypt. And then Yah gave the Levites to the priesthood to assist them. But the Levites are not priests unless they had the priesthood. We know the priests are other descendants of Levi, but once they become known as priests, they no longer referred to as Levites. Levites don't do the office of a priest. Huh? Priest to priest, Levites to Levites. There's certain things Levites cannot do. Can't look at the holy things. Not only can't look at them, can't handle them unless they've been wrapped by the priest, right? Right? We know Melchizedek was not a priest. That ain't even been set up yet. That don't start to be set up till Exodus chapter 25, after he come, brought Israel out of Egypt. Right? As Esau, you understand, trying to combine the governorship and the priesthood. You cannot combine those two things. Those are two separate lines forever. Right? One is the line of Zadok, the priesthood. One is the line of Dawid, the governorship. So Melchizedek is a fictitional character, right? You follow me? Yeah, stand over there in Hebrews chapter 7. Shalom laid that on me here a while back. I mentioned it, past, right? You understand? He had no line of descent. You know what I mean? He had no father. He had no mother. Well, if that's the case, he didn't exist. Because that's the only way human beings get here. You follow me? As we come back around to that, Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. You follow me? This JC, he's supposed to be, you understand, come by the Spirit. You understand what I mean? The Holy Ghost, right? Well, then he ain't the line of David for sure, because the only way the line of David can get here is through, you understand, intercourse. Because it's a bloodline. The Spirit don't have no bloodline, because Yah is Spirit. He ain't flesh. See? So, you understand what I'm saying? See, so when you get your mind around on the story, and then Yah, as a tree, you keep getting stronger. Your trunk keeps getting bigger. You keep developing those rings through the years, right? Of growth, branches. The tree gets fuller and fuller and fuller if you plugged into Yah's host, your creator. And again, I don't care what your nationality is. Yah created us all. But Yah is he who creates. That's what his name means. He's the king. There are no others, and there's nobody with him. Deuteronomy 32:39. Zechariah chapter 14, after the last battle, right? Yah's name gonna be one, he gonna be one in all the earth. Huh? Over there in Deuteronomy, what is it, chapter 4 or 6, right? Yah is one, his name is one. One, not two. See? So again, those of us who plugged into Yah, those of us who represent Yah, huh? That's why I went to the memorial for this brother who died with the worms eating him up. 51, Yeshaya, verse 7 and 8. But he, you know, he had some knowledge. He was supposed to be, you know, talking about pure blood and telling people about herbs and whatnot. How this keep from you getting cancer? How this keep you from getting sick and this and that? See? But that's what happened to him. Prostate cancer. Worms ate him up. See? That's why he didn't want to see nobody. The last year and a half. You follow me? And again, I'm not happy or sad. I'm just observing and substantiating the word of Yah. And again, when you look at Yeshaya chapter 66, what does it say? When Yah runs these Edomites out of the land of Israel, from Jerusalem, into their land and burns them up, what does he say? He going to send out runners, messengers to the nations, huh? Who have not heard his fame nor seen his glory. Okay, what's his glory? His arm, his movement, his vineyard of red wine. Those of us who have turned to Yah with all our heart and soul, totally submitted and committed. in obeying compliance to Yah's righteousness with all our heart, all our soul. Deuteronomy 30, verse 2. We're in a time of trouble, never been since it's been a nation. Okay? It's no equivocating the seriousness of the time we live in. And it hasn't reached its peak. It's going to get exponentially worse for those who are not plugged into Yah of hosts, their creator, who are not totally committed and submitted. Yah is the Savior. There is none else. He's salvation, and He alone. There is none else. You've got people running around now, huh? And you're going to have more running to get gold and silver. Huh? But like I said to this person last night, and like I said to all of you in the past, right? You read Ezekiel chapter 7. What did y'all say? Our forefathers, children of Israel, our forefathers, right? They thought silver and gold was going to save them, but it didn't. Right? When y'all brought the you understand, on Jerusalem and Yahuda Benjamin, the Chaldeans and the Babylonians, it already hadn't saved the 10 tribes prior to that, right? And when y'all brought Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians, what did he say? You understand? Your silver and gold ain't going to save you. And it didn't. See? And the same thing today. You know, when y'all brings his, your recompense upon you for your ways, I don't care how much silver and gold you got, diamonds and emeralds, they ain't going to save you. See? But again, as I said, you know, person last night, I've said to all of you in the past, you know, I mean, Yah gives wisdom and understanding to those who pursue in Him and who submit and obey Him. And again, you know, like I said with Asa, right? He sought to the physicians because he became totally adversarial to Yah. You understand? He wasn't going to humble himself and pray to Yah and ask for forgiveness, acknowledge what he had done was incorrect, his wrong, right? How he exacerbated it by striking the messenger that Yah sent to him, the prophet, and imprisoning him. He didn't acknowledge that. And so what eventually happened to Asa over the next 2 to 3 years, his feet, the anger of Yah was, you understand, beamed in on Asa through his feet. His feet totally rotted out to the point where his feet stank so bad when he died from this disease in his feet. His feet were so rotten and it stank so bad, they had to fill his sepulcher with all kind of sweet odors and stuff, trying to kill the stink of his feet. Look at Uzzah. That's another thing that knocks out Melchizedek. You cannot combine, huh, the governorship and the priesthood. You can't do it. Isn't that what Uzzah, Azariah tried to do? He when his heart, he was by Yah all these years, 30-something years too, right? And then his heart was lifted up. He went into the temple. He wanted to do the office of the priest. And they, you know, talk to him. The priest talk to high priest. You know, this don't pertain to you, man. Huh? But he persisted. What did y'all do? Smote him with the leprosy. Came up into his forehead. And when that happened, huh? The priest picked him up and threw him out the temple. Now, he went and spent the rest of his life living in the several house. Separated. A leper. Died a leper. Now, you know, huh? Yah, if Yah turned Miriam back after 7 days, but you know she humbled herself, you know that. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, Moshe, he interceded, you know, but Yah, hey, even if her father spit in her face, she's going to be unclean 7 days. So, you know, but at the end, you know Miriam humbled herself. I talked about this before, right? At the end of 7 days, Yah took the leprosy off of her, and you don't hear Miriam get out of place again. Right? See? And it was all about what? Zipporah. Not the Ethiopian woman. You know, we talked about that here the other month. Right? We know now. You understand? Like I said the other month, you know, this person brought this forward in another way here about 3-4 years ago. You found about 4 years ago. And I said, you know, it's say Ethiopian, what you talking about? You know, Midianite, he probably knew that then, but he didn't share that with us. But eventually, Yah brought us that illumination. Now we understand it's not the Ethiopian wife Moses took, it's talking about Zipporah. See, she was a Midianite, and she was not embraced by Miriam, and Moses, you understand, in-laws. And probably Miriam, you know, got some other Israelites to, you know, be against her. See? That's why Moshe had to send her back with the children to Jethro when he first go him, you know, him and Aharon first come down into Egypt. Because like he said, like, I ain't got time to deal with this. I'm gonna send you back. You understand? You understand? Maybe I can talk to them and get them to, you know, embrace you when, you know, when Yah does what he say he gonna do with us and bring us out of Egypt, and then you know you have Jethro bring you and the children back to me. Maybe by that time, you understand, they'll deal with you better. But I ain't got time to deal with this now, all right? Cause I got to do the work of Yah. See. And then when they came out of Egypt, Jethro brought her and the two boys to Moshe, but it didn't get no better. And Miriam is the main one, the main instigator of this. That's why Yah hit her with the leprosy. Right, but after that, right, you didn't hear nothing from Miriam again. Now she know her place, and not to get out of her place. See, we know she had to humble herself and pray to Yah, oh Yah, please turn me back. Right? Well, Yah could have done the same thing with Uzziah, isn't that right? But Uzziah never humbled himself. He got like Asa. Had to, because he died a leper. And you know that leprosy got worse as time went on, to possibly, you know, fingers dropping off, toes dropping off, ears dropping off. You follow what I'm saying? There is no offense or defense against Yah. How you gonna get angry at Yah, he who creates? See, and this is what Yah is in the process of showing everybody. Huh? The Edomites, huh? Israelites, all mankind. I don't care who Yah or who you think you are. Like I say, take a good look at Nebuchadnezzar, Daniel chapter 4. Take a good look at Amenophis II over there in Exodus. Huh? What did Yah tell Amenophis II? What was that chapter 9, Exodus? For in this cause have I raised you up. You understand what I'm saying? Well, I'm going to make an example out of you. Did he do the same thing with David? After David committed adultery, rape, adultery, and murder. Right? Rape, adultery, and murder. David committed. Right? And what did Yah say? I'm going to make an example out of you. You understand? That's what he said the time to tell him. You know? See? Yeah, I didn't look over it. You know, how's he written there? You know, because some people, like I say, they, you know, they look at it, you know, Esau, the way Esau wrote it, he wrote it deceptively. You understand what I'm saying? But you know, the way it's written is like, verse 13, the 2 Samuel chapter 12, right? And what does it say? And Dawid said unto Nathan, I have sinned against Yah. And Nathan said unto Dawid, Yah also hath put away thy sin, you shall not die. But that's not true.
Now, the not dying, you understand what I mean? He eventually died, but he's like, he ain't going to kill you now. But Yah's not put away, didn't put away that we sin. You understand? That's Esau's interpretation. That's his mess. Yah didn't put away David's sin. Yah like, I'm going to deal with you in a certain way. Anybody that see this from here on out, they're not going to ever do this again. If they do, they know what they got coming. Because I'm going to torture you. I'm putting a sword in your house for the rest of your life. Okay? I'm going to make an example out of you. See? Anybody that gets the thought that they can do this, just go read about David and see what happened to him. You know, you better get that thought out your heart. Out your mind. Okay? See? David was tortured the last like 16, 17 years of his life. That's what I figured. 16, 17 years. See? So, there is no offense or defense against Yah. You know, how are you going to deceive him? And again, if you deceive humans for a while, like we see Laban did, huh, with Yaakov, like we see Yaakov did with his father for that moment, he deceived him at the behest of his mother, right? But then he realized, what, years later, huh, maybe by what, 15, not matter of fact, no, longer than that, what, well, you know, maybe by what, 12 years later? Not quite 12, maybe, maybe around 12 years later. Then he realized I didn't messed up. Maybe a little longer than that, maybe 13 years. I didn't messed up. I got to acknowledge, see? And then that's when he acknowledged it to himself. He acknowledged it to Yah. And I know he acknowledged it to Leah and Raquel, see? And then when he went into Leah after that, now he can, once he acknowledged, now Yah, you understand, changed his spirit. Now he can see Leah for what she really represented. Because all Leah wanted was to be embraced by Yaakov. She didn't care nothing about him having Raquel as a wife too. Leah didn't care about that. But again, we can see it was acrimony developed between them, you understand? More so probably coming from Raquel initially because, again, huh? That's why Yah say in the law, don't take two sibling sisters to wife. See? And Yaakov knew the law. He did it anyway. See? Because he wanted Raquel. See? But he got that deception back that he had put on his father from his uncle. You receive what you put out. You get recompense. Everybody does. Whether it's good or evil, you're going to get it back. That's why I've said in the past, the person truly understood, they'd only do what's good. So they get that back. See? But the deal comes in, what is good? What is right? What is justice? See? And that's the statutes, orders, judgments, commandments, and precepts of Yah of hosts. That's what's right in Yah's eyes. Not man's. We got to get in harmony with Yah. He don't get in harmony with us. Okay? Now, and we got to learn how to care about the way of Yah with all our heart and all our soul. See? And once you truly get to the place where you can discern that and understand that, hey, that's everything. See? Because that's life there. That's blessings and long life. See? So again, you follow me? Yah's way is the only way. There is no equivocation. There is no substitute. It's not about your way, my way, huh? Any other person's ways. Again, it's not about religions. Because all religions, come out of the heart of a man or men? Like I said in the past, just look up the word religion and look at the etymology of the word. It's a belief conceived by human beings. The way of Yah, Ezekiel chapter 20, is a way of life. Deuteronomy 30 verse 2. You understand? You're doing it, all of it. You're living it or not. You're doing it or not. It's not a belief. It's a way of life. See? So, all of you out there, I don't care who you are or who you think you are. You follow me? Turn to Yah with all your heart and soul if you want to be delivered out of this judgment that Yah is bringing on the inhabitants of the earth to make his judgment rest for a light to the people. See? Turn to Yah of hosts with all your heart and soul. Submit. Purge yourself of the ways of the heathen. The ways of man. Give yourself to Yah of hosts. Because he and he alone is salvation. There is no other. See? And if you refuse to do that, then your situation is going to get worse. Not better. It's going to get worse. And if you maintain that stance, you will be destroyed by following the imaginations of your own heart, by refusing to submit and embrace the laws, statutes, ordinances, judgments, commandments, and precepts of Yah of hosts, your creator. So now here are these Democracy Now! Shows for July, and these couple here in August. July the 3rd. Matter of fact, I mentioned that on the last session, right? That's the one with Angela Davis, Cornel West, and Kiana Taylor. I mentioned that last session, but okay, July the 10th. They're talking about Brazil and the COVID outbreak. Okay. And the landowners and, you know, the religions and stuff they in, the peasants and whatnot, what religions and what the landowners is doing to the peasants, so-called peasants, right? That's July the 10th. July the 13th, talking about something was going down in what went down in Bloomington, Indiana. July the 15th, make sure you listen to the opening statements. You know, the first like 15 minutes, you know, what Amy Goodman is talking about. July the 16th, they're talking about George Floyd again. July the 24th, right? Noam Chomsky was on that show. Check that out. And don't forget, Noam Chomsky's an Edomite. Okay? You know, but he talks about Trump being a nut. No good. But talking about this nuclear thing. He's talking about some stuff, but check it out. And then July the 30th, okay? Chomsky again, part two. And August, like I said earlier, the 3rd, yesterday, not the 3rd, but the 4th. Make sure you watch the opening statements of that, because they're going to show you how that brother was killed. I didn't catch where it was. Did the similar thing to you know, what they did to Eric Garner and George Floyd, did the similar thing to him. And then the Democracy Now! Today, you know, make sure you check that out. They're talking about Beirut, and they got this Lebanese
person who's on there talking about how this, you know, not only the Trump administration, but he said America over like the last 20 years, he said their policy is totally inane in dealing with, as he called it, the Arab world, or the Ishmaelite world is what it is, right? And over there in the East, he said the policies of America have been totally, you know, just like off the chain. You know, it's just totally inane and ridiculous and ludicrous how they've been dealing with these nations over in the East the last 20 years. But, you know, you need to listen to it, okay? And then they're also talking about what happened in Beirut, you know, with this big, huge explosion, all right? And they're trying, you know, they're investigating it to get to the bottom of it, if they can, to see, you know, just what caused it. But, you know, quite naturally, the Edomites, you know, they denied any involvement, and Hezbollah said they didn't have anything to do with it. But again, we'll see, you know, because again, everything is brought out into the light now. There is no hiding, you know, today, right? Everything, y'all bringing everything out into the light. Okay, so we got newspaper articles as usual. And oh yeah, before I forget, thank you, y'all. Good brother, in New York, Brother Yacob, I'm not Yacob, but Yehuda, Brother Yehuda of the Law Keepers, he called. And last session, you know, I was talking about the person who called out of Indiana who wanted to get circumcised. And he said he had five sons. He wanted to get them circumcised. And Brother Yehuda, the Law Keepers, heard me talking about him. So he called me like Yehuda. He said, you know, you can put out to the people that it's through, if you have a urologist or you go to a urologist, you want to get circumcised. Okay, he says, because he got it done through his job, he had insurance. And he went to the urologist, got circumcised, and the insurance that he has on his job paid for it. So all of you out there, whomever you may be, okay, you males out there, you know, you've got to be circumcised, right, to be in, you know, be in harmony with Yah. You definitely have to be circumcised in the foreskin of your flesh. But all of you out there, males or females, you have to be circumcised in the foreskin of your heart to Yah, right? But all you males out there that possibly, in the, you know, right now looking for, you know, a way to get circumcised, or you're looking to how to get circumcised, or where you should go to a urologist. Because the brother told me that's who does that. Okay, and if you got a job and you got some insurance coverage, it's a good possibility the insurance will pay for it. Okay? Again, first newspaper article, July the 4th. Netflix moving $100 million to help bolster black banks. Streaming company aims to address multifaceted issue. Again, this person called me last night. And she was telling me about this Hebrew get it right in my mind. Credit, like a credit union that has been established. Like a Hebrew Israelite credit union, or kind of like a bank, but it's like, I think she said credit union like. For Hebrew Israelites, and she didn't say Hebrew Israelites, she says Hebrews. But I mentioned that to her, I'm pretty sure, you know, Hebrew Israelites, right? But if I didn't, I know she's going to be listening, she's going to hear me talk about this. It's Hebrew Israelites, right? It's supposed to be establishing a credit union for Israelites to place their money. But like I said to her, you know, and I didn't, you know, she heard me. I hope she understood me. As I've said to all of you in the past, again, now is not the time.
and it never will be again. Okay? Because we're transitioning out of this dominion of man into the dominion of Yah, as I said earlier, I said last session, right? Now is not the time, and it never will be again, to place your assets in paper. Okay? If you got any kind of understanding, you know, per se today, any illumination, you understand, you see what time it is. Now is the time to start, you know, coming out of the paper assets and going into precious metals or you know, as I said in the past, swag, right? S-W-A-G, silver, wine, art, gold. Now, I got another article in the stage I'm going to read later about how this, you know, these wine vineyards are backed up because these vineyard growers over in Europe, and this one is dealing with basically France, is what I saw, but I think they mentioned Italy and some others, where they got these vineyards, they can't bring their wine, you know, because of this COVID thing. And also, you know, Trump put a 25% surtax on French wines, okay? And then more likely, it's probably something on the Italian, but it's the COVID-19. And also, before I forget, you know, those of you out there, if you go to your computer and type in COVID gate or COVID-19 gate, right? But I think it's COVID gate because Yadasa, Yacob and Yadasa, you know, brought this to me here other week. You type that in, you Google it, like it's on YouTube. At least it was, unless they take it down. We just saw it a few days ago again. COVID gate, right? It's a 1 minute, little 1 minute shot where they show you one of these workers who put up these 5G towers. And again, Jacob told me the other week too, it is the 5G, you know, I was saying 5 and 6G, again, because I heard, you know, somebody on RT here last week say 5 and 6G too. And I said, okay, I've been saying 5 and 6G because generally it's, you know, the way I can see it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, you know, they generally say 5G, right? But Jacob told me here the other week, he said, Yehuda, it goes up to 10G. He's looking at something. He said, it goes from 5 to 10G, these towers they putting up now. Okay? Like I said, what, a couple of months back, you know they can turn this stuff up and down. Frequencies, right? He told me it goes from 5 to 10G, these towers they putting up now. All right, so now, if you, like I say, you type in COVID gate, right? And it might be COVID-19 gate, right? But they show you a 1 minute video where this worker who's putting up the towers, he's working on the tower. They got the tower behind him. You can see it is up high, right? And he got his face with the mask on. He got his helmet on, his work suit, right? And he shows you the schematic board, right? The electronic board that goes up into the side of the tower, you know, with all the little, you know, electronic gizmos and stuff on the board, right? Electronic board. And up in the corner, it says COVID-19. And it's not written in. It's like, just like the little metal pieces for the electronic, you know, on the board. It's in metal. Up in the left-hand corner of the board. And he showed it to you. He like, man, look at this. COVID-19 on the electronic board that goes up in the tower. Now, you can see it for yourself unless they take it down, see? And he was like, what is this? I'm putting this stuff in here, you know what I'm saying? Now, you called me Yahadasa. Yahadasa said it, because I was looking at it, it looked like It's like over there in England, maybe, or over there in Europe. But she said it was here, but I don't know. Because I looked at the little car that was sitting there, and some of them, like, real quick, because it's quick, right? Like, I saw a little row house. Kind of looked like Europe to me, like England or maybe Ireland, because he kind of had a brogue on him. But she said it was his, but so I don't know. But all you take a look at. Okay, they got COVID-19 on the electronic board that goes up into the tower. I tell you, plandemic. Okay, but again, you know, this is, you know, we were looking at ITM metals, IT metals, ITM. Caucasian sister, her name is Lynette. It's kind of old, you know, about 60. Right, she wears glasses, you know, real personable. But she, you know, got this, they're into metals, buying metals and whatnot, you know, and they into it. And we watch her at different times, and she was taking questions. They were emailing her questions, and one of the questions here the other day, last week, was like somebody emailed and said, "Yeah, my financial advisor says it's a good time to get into bonds." And this, she just laughed, right? She said, "Hey, this is no time to be into any kind of paper assets." Okay. See, like we showed everybody here a few years ago, the inverted pyramid, the whole paper world. Paper asset world is collapsing as I speak. It hasn't just started. Like we, you know, played for everybody here back in, late 2017 or early 2018, when that Lisa Havens said that the Rothschilds had divested all of their investments, you know, in America, out of America in September of 2017. They took all their investments out of America. Again, that's handwriting on the wall. All right? It's no time to be in the paper assets. Everybody's trying to get down there in that capstone in the inverted pyramid where the precious metals and the diamonds and the emeralds and sapphires, you know what I'm saying? Art. You follow what I'm saying? We ain't really in the art, right? You know what I'm saying? And we can't, you know, buy that expensive wine. You follow what I'm saying? But gold is now really getting more expensive for many of us. Can buy, maybe some of us without a doubt, you know, can get gold, right? And today, before we did the session, gold, it jumped up to $2,050. Okay? Now, it might not end up today, like, but it's going up. Because we looked at a thing here the other day, and Peter Schiff and Jim Rickards, right? And they both, you know, they talking, you know, in another 2 to 3 years, gold could go to anywhere from $15,000 to $40,000 an ounce. It's just, they don't know where it's, you know, but they know it's going up because that's how worthless the paper is becoming. And it's picking up speed exponentially. You know, it's just picking up speed. Now you see the silver was over $27 today. See? And again, you know, they go up and then they kind of come down, but they're going up. And that's where they're going because the paper, pardon me, is becoming more and more worthless. So you don't want to be in any kind of paper assets. So that's why when, you know, the sister said to me last night, you know, they setting up some kind of Hebrew credit union banking situation, you know. You know what I mean? For Hebrew Israelites, evidently, I mean, that don't make any sense to me. You ain't supposed to be trying to hold paper now, right? Because, again, like another brother now was talking, he said, well, you know, somebody got $1 million today, you know, in paper. I said, right. It just sits there like I say, like water in a pot that's got a flame up under it. It, you know, the pot, you fill up the pot with water, right? You turn the flame up under it. And you understand? You walk away, you go away, come back a few minutes later, and where the water was at the top of the pot, now it's down half the pot. If you leave the flame and you walk away, come back later, you might, that pot might be burning up because the water is all evaporated. Well, that's what's going on with paper assets.
is being eroded, you know, evaporating right before your eyes. That's why, you know, as the paper assets world starts to collapse, you know, people in the know, they start coming down into that capstone in the inverted pyramid, because that's where all of the gold, the silver, like I say, you know, the things of worth are in that capstone. And everybody can't get down there. Okay, we just was watching David Morgan this past weekend. His silver is his thing. Been in for years. We've watched him in the past. And he said even Warren Buffett has bought a big hunk of silver. See? So it's time to get out of paper of any kind. And again, you know, if you are property, if you got property, it's paid for, great. But if you got property where you owe on, where you like, you know, you got rental property for people to rent, you and you got a mortgage that you got to pay, you're in a little bit of trouble. Now, it all depends on, you know, how big your cushion is up under you. You know, how much real assets you have. Because you're going to have to pay the light bill and the gas bill, you know, and the water bill and the taxes on your properties, because you got many of your renters can't pay rent, but you still got to pay that mortgage. Now, if your property's paid for, great. But then as you lose renters, or renters are in there and can't pay, right? Like many can't now, and more coming who are not going to be able to pay, right? Because more likely than not, they're going to do another shutdown, you know? You know, like a brother and I were talking here a few days ago, you know, you understand? The people have been getting left and right hooks from the sword, but it's really from Yah. Working through the sword. These left and right hooks, you know, Joe Frazier left hooks. You follow what I'm saying? And you understand what I mean? Jack Johnson, right crosses, yes, they're knockout punch. I'm trying to think somebody with a devastating right? And then a Muhammad Ali flurry. You understand what I'm saying? That's what Yah is bringing on the people of the world through the sword, the illuminated Edomites, the bankers. Okay? A time of trouble never been since it's been a nation, with all of the, you understand, the agricultural collapse, you know, the environmental collapse. See? And again, this is from man's inventions and man's idolatries, right? And his inventions, you know, like again, what does Solomon say in Ecclesiastes? Yah has made man upright, but he has sought out many inventions. And from these inventions that man has come up with that's supposed to be so great, like I've said in the past, we know now they're really not great. They're detrimental. You know, like the combustible engine, and you breathing in carbon monoxide that can kill you, right? You follow what I'm saying? Chemtrails that these planes are emitting, of which the carbon monoxide from, you understand, combustible engines is adding to. That's why, again, you understand, this Elon Musk with his Tesla motors and these electric cars, right? But they need batteries. They need lithium to make these batteries that drive these, you know, electric vehicles, right? That's why they overthrew the boy down there in Bolivia here the other year. Evo was his name. Was it Evo Morales? You know, the president. They cooled him, ran him up out of there, and put their people in place, because Bolivia got the biggest, you know, understand, a depository of lithium in the world. And they need lithium for these electric vehicle batteries. And so they say Elon Musk, he was part of that cooing Evo Morales. He was behind that. He had something to do with that. He give him money, whatever. But you understand? Because he need that lithium for these batteries. See, that's the daughter of Babylon. That's Dracul. See what I'm saying?
Same thing that they keep on harping on Maduro, because you understand Venezuela got the most oil on any other country in the world and the best oil of any other country in the world. Yada just told me the other day, because I was gone when I got back here, she said, yeah, Yaudi said had that Elliot Abram, that Edomite, on talking again about we, you know, Maduro this, Maduro that. We got to get Guaido in there. Okay. See, you follow me? Still on that. You follow me? Sanctions on Venezuela. Sanctions on Lebanon. When you listening to all this, you understand? You listen to the right channel, they're going to tell you about how, you know, America Trump didn't put all these sanctions, had all these sanctions on Lebanese, the Lebanese. And that's why, and Trump came out this morning and said, you know, he said the generals at the Pentagon didn't tell him this. They claimed they didn't know. But he said he think it was a bomb that exploded in Beirut. See? Now, you understand what I'm saying? And more likely than not, that could very well be it. Okay? Because check this out. You watch Democracy Now! This morning. They talk about how Pompeo, he called the ex-prime minister of Lebanon, not the prime minister that's there now. And that's what you're going to hear this guy that was on Democracy Now! This morning. He said, you know, the Trump administration and the administrations before it, going all the way back to Clinton. He said they policies toward the East, the Mideast, the so-called Mideast, and the East. He said, and he called it the Arab world. It's been totally inane all these years. He said they don't have a clue on how to deal with these nations. See? Okay? Now, and again, when I say this, just remember again what I read there right at the end of Daniel chapter 11. The last couple of verses there. About the king of the south. That's Islam. See? But this again is from Yah. See what I'm saying? This is from Yah. See? Because Islam got to go out. You understand? Just like Judaism, Zionism got to go out. Just like Christianity got to go out. Hinduism, Buddhism, all these religions, all these ways of the heathen got to go out. Because none of that can transition over into the dominion of Yah, this fifth dominion, right? Again, because the kingdom has always been Yah's, from generation to generation. Daniel chapter 40, isn't that what Nebuchadnezzar said? The kingdom's always been Yah. He lift up whoever he lifts up, give him dominion. Just like he gave Yahosef dominion down there in Egypt, right? Had he, you understand, gave Pharaoh the two dreams, and then, you understand, Yah gave Yahosef the ability to decipher dream and that he had done a couple years earlier with the baker and the butler, and the butler was restored, right? The baker was hanged, and he told the butler, don't forget about me. And when it was advantageous for the butler to remember him, the butler remembered him, told Pharaoh, this is the man down there in the prison that can decipher dream. You follow me? So Pharaoh had him brought. What happened? Same day, you understand? Yosef was lifted up and given total power over Egypt. The only one he had to answer to was Pharaoh. And Pharaoh just let him run it. And the Pharaoh after him, he kept everything the same way. Yosef, you handle it, you running it. And all of the little gnomes or the secondary governors, it was about six or seven, eight of them, you understand, along the Nile, who, you understand, had all their dominion dried up and went into Yosef. He running the whole shebang. And that was Yah giving him dominion. And this is what's in the process of happening now. Yah setting up his dominion. And all these dominions of man, dominions of the illuminated Edomites, they're going to get dried up. And all of that dominion is coming up to under the king, the Yah of hosts, the Most High. See, he's setting up his dominion. And it's coming back around full circle to the first dominion. Again, Micah chapter 4. Because the first dominion on earth was Yah's dominion. He's the one that is giving man dominion, right? At different times. Now he's setting up his dominion forever. July the 8th. Coronavirus aid to businesses. How Washington helped but overspent on PPP. Said, did you see which Illinois millionaires got big bucks from the federal government's coronavirus rescue package while most businesses suffered? That's one interpretation of the data released Monday on organizations that received an aid via the Payroll Protection Program. In reality, the $660 billion aid program appears to have accomplished its broad aim of providing assistance to many smaller businesses in the form of forgivable loans so they could continue to operate and make payroll during a pandemic that might otherwise have capsized them. It's a massive federal program, though, so expect there to be waste and don't be too shocked by allegations of fraud or misuse. We also suspect this program could have done just as much good for half the cost. Count on Washington to overspend. Nice-sized article, but you get the gist. Huh? Huh? Fraud and waste. Right? And most of the money, you follow me, goes to these businesses that shouldn't be even getting any bailout or any money. They already billionaire corporations or multi-millionaire corporations. So let them reach in their pocket and keep their businesses going. Right? I mean, it's just like, you know, the owners of the LA Lakers, right? Jeannie Buss, right? They applied evidently and got like about $4 to $5 million in aid because of the shutdown, but she got, I guess, got wise. She sent the money back. So that's all right. We don't need it. She sent the money back to her because they don't need it. I know the Lakers, I know her family probably worth $1 billion or better. You understand what I'm saying? See? So she sent the money back. But most of these businesses who, you understand, they didn't send it back. You know, it's just like I'm pretty sure I got an article, but I wait till I get to it. Okay. July the 8th, New York fines Deutsche Bank for dealings with Epstein. Jeffrey Epstein, right? Firm to pay $150 million settlement over suspicious transactions. Now that's the Deutsche Bank. Okay. Said payments to his alleged co-conspirators, money wired to Russian models, a cash withdrawal of $100,000 for tips and household expenses. When Jeffrey Epstein moved his money, Deutsche Bank did not ask many questions. In a $150 million settlement announced Tuesday, the New York Department of Financial Services said that Epstein, a convicted sex offender, engaged in suspicious transactions for years, even though Deutsche Bank had deemed him a high-risk client from the moment he became a customer in the summer of 2013. According to the release, the agreement marked the first enforcement action by a regulator against a financial institution for dealing with the financier. A year and a day after Epstein was arrested on federal sex trafficking charges. The settlement described how bank employees relied on informal meetings and institutional momentum to allow suspicious activity to proceed largely unchecked. Instead of performing appropriate due diligence on Epstein and the activity in his accounts, regulators wrote, the bank was focused on his potential to generate millions of dollars of revenue as well as leads for other lucrative clients. Deutsche Bank acknowledged that it had erred in bringing Epstein on as a client and that its processes had been weak. Yeah, right. You understand what I mean? He eat a mic, right? And he's got the okay from, you understand, the higher ups, right? Because again, this is again how the Illuminated Edomite, you follow me, sets these sex traps up, like they said the drug traps, you follow me, and all these different traps, because he's the hunter. So he sets these sex traps up for these different, you understand, people, you understand, of stature, you understand, and that he puts in place to get stuff on them, so he can keep a dossier on them. You follow me? Like the Clintons. You follow me? You know they got a dossier on the Bushes. You follow what I'm saying? But, you know, he ain't got to worry about W getting out of line. You follow what I'm saying? Because W was raised by his daddy and his daddy by his granddaddy. You understand what I'm saying? They skull and bone boys, and they hooked in, right? But, you know, you understand? They got dossiers on your Oprah Winfreys, your Michael Jordans. Your Shaquille O'Neal's, your Charles Barkley's, your Cornel West, you know, your Tavis Smileys and your Al Sharptons and your Jesse Jacksons. They got dossiers on, you know, Eric Prince and Betty DeVos. You understand what I mean? They got dossiers on Trump. You dig? They got dossiers on everybody. And so, again, they send out, you understand, Epstein and that Ghislaine Maxwell, you understand, agents to get all of these tapes, you know, and about sexual habits and sexual addictions. The Prince Andrew, right? You follow me? And no telling who else. Anybody and everybody, they can get into the net, you understand, and get a dossier on them. Pictures, tapes, right? I still, like I'm saying, you know, all them CDs and DVDs they say they confiscated out of Jeffrey Epstein's condo in New York when the FBI went in there. We ain't heard any of those yet. How long ago was that? Year and a half ago or something? How, you know, we gonna ever hear them tapes? We ever gonna see them DVDs? Don't bet on it. Because again, like I said in the past, you know, like that book, you know, Red Fog Over America by William Guy Carr. See? Okay? He talking about, you understand? You understand? The hidden hand, the illuminated Edomite. He don't use that. I don't recall him using that term. But, you know, the establishment, that's what they do. You understand? They build up dossiers on everybody that they put in these different positions. So if anybody gets out of pocket, out of place, they can come down on them and expose them. See, that's why you don't have to worry about Oprah Winfrey coming out saying anything, you know, pertinent. See what I'm saying? Because they blow her out the water. See, just like they had a dossier on J. Edgar Hoover. Follow what I'm saying? And again, that lets you know Maya Lansky and the Jewish mob, you did that part of the mob, you understand? And the tags was up under it too, but they was more likely working through Maya Lansky. You follow what I'm saying? They had a dossier on J. Edgar Hoover where, you know, he didn't try to attack the mob because, you know, for years he said it wasn't no organized crime. Okay? You follow what I'm saying? Now, you know what I mean? They talk about who, but he knew what he could and couldn't do. And more likely than not, they probably got rid of him because he was a flaming homosexual, per se. You understand what I mean? He put on his act out in public, but, you know, behind closed doors, you know, he wearing his brassiere and garters and everything, too. They got a dossier on him. That's what they get on people. That's why just here, a few weeks ago, here the other month, man, like early part of July, I can't remember. Matter of fact, it was, I don't know this guy's name. He's on IT at different times, and he's in these discussions. And it was Rick Sanchez's show he was on, and it was one or two other people that, you know, they had the split screen, about three, four people on the screen. And they were talking about, you know, media and whatnot. And this guy, he dog hair, he wear glasses. He looked like he's like in his 50s. You know, and he said, you know, if you go against the establishment, in other words, you got to be squeaky clean. He said, because if you're not, he said, they're going to come at you, you understand, and expose you with something. He said, they're going to come at you and attack you with something. You understand? So he said, you got to be squeaky clean. Okay? All right. Chicago Tribune, July the 8th. Now, say, is it so, Joe? Now, for all of you out there that, you know, into baseball. Now, that's the senior umpire for the Major League Baseball here in America. His name is Joe West. Okay? Now, check and say, West, Joe West, right? Skepticism about the COVID-19 death count puts belligerent umpires' judgment under fire before MLB, Major League Baseball, season even began. Because Joe West said he don't believe all these deaths they are giving to COVID-19 is true. Now, this is an umpire. Now, you know he got, you understand, he got reach with different people around the country and possibly in the world. You know, definitely in the Western world. You follow what I'm saying? Because he the major league, senior major league baseball umpire. Been in baseball for years. Joe West, right? They say when you see Joe West is trending on Twitter and the baseball season has yet to begin, you tend to feel the worst. Fortunately, Country Joe, that's what they call him, quote unquote, right? Country Joe was alive and well Tuesday. And the only reason America was talking about the game's most controversial umpire stemmed from an ignorant comment West made about the coronavirus outbreak to the Athletics. Ken Rosenthal, this Edomite. Now, this is a guy named Paul Sullivan who writes it. So you already hear how he's impugning, you understand, Joe West and what Joe West said. He said this ignorant, right, comment that Joe West made. In an interview about the 67-year-old West's decision to work this season in spite of being in the high-risk category for contracting COVID-19, the veteran umpire said he told Major League Baseball, quote, "I don't believe in my heart that all these deaths have been from coronavirus. I believe it may have contributed to some of the deaths." He said, "I'm not going to opt out. I'm going to work, and I'm going to work until you take me off the field or I get hurt, whatever I'm working." Okay? Unquote. So, you understand what I'm saying? He like, "I don't believe all this death is from no COVID-19. All right? And that's the same thing Gerald Celente said, same thing I say, same thing different people is saying. The Illuminated Edomite knows this. He knows this. Plenty of people out there that are privy that this is game, this is being game worked on the masses of the people. Like I said earlier today, right? It's only been, you know, a little over 700,000 people, so they say, that have died across the face of the earth from COVID-19. The population is estimated 7.8 billion people. So that's like a blip on the screen. I mean, you get that many people that die from smoking cigarettes and reefer. And cocaine and whatnot. And, you understand? And heroin. You understand? Chasing the dragon every year. You're probably getting more people dying from that every year than you getting from so-called COVID-19. You getting, you understand, that many people probably dying from what? Bombs and bullets and wars. You understand? Every year. You getting more likely more people that than that that's dying from car accidents across the face of the earth. Have they removed, you know, vehicles off the face of the earth? Have they shut down cars? Have they taken the guns and the bullets and the bombs from people? You understand what I'm saying? Huh? They made smoking marijuana legal in many states here in America. Just here in Chicago, I mean in Illinois, they were saying that, I just saw here the other week, supposedly, just this past week, they sold over $37 million worth of marijuana. Matter of fact, that's here in Chicago. Not just the state, that's here in Chicago. Because the article was about how much, you know, the marijuana selling is going up. People buying marijuana from these dispensaries. And also, the dispensaries are basically owned by Edomites and pale-faced Caucasians. Okay, because there's plenty different ones of us that have applied, you understand, and they won't allow them to actually open up. They keeping them from getting the permit to open up. But they passed out everything. They've invested money, and you got different ones of us that's standing there, you know, all ready to open up, and they losing money now because, you understand, they got money invested. Did I read that on the last session? About the sister, her and another sister or two, they done invested money and they got to pay $5,000, what is it, a week or a month for this place they got. And they withholding the permit for them to actually start selling. And it's a few others of us here in Chicago that's got, passed all of what stuff, invested money and waiting for their permit to actually sell. But they keeping them from actually selling and they losing money. You follow what I'm saying? That's you know, as, again, where's the equity? But again, they ain't supposed to be selling no weed, no way. But you know what I'm saying, right? I'm telling you, you're never going to get any equality in this fourth dimension. Israel, you're just not going to get it, right? Also, Chicago Sun-Times, July the 9th, Trump Tulsa rally likely source of COVID-19 surge. Because nobody was wearing a mask, right? It's out of Oklahoma City where they had the rally. All these people came. They sitting right next to each other. Wasn't any 6-foot distancing, right? And nobody was wearing a mask. You know Trump didn't have one on. So now, what's that all about? But they keep talking about won't anybody wear masks and 6 feet apart. I tell you, it's a game. It's an attack. Plandemic. Okay?